November 11th, 2007 meeting of the Newmarket Planning Board. As is probably obvious at this point, or too late to notice, the 6 p.m. site walk was canceled. And I was asked to send out notice that the Bosinger Family Trust application, the Dodds property, is going to be continued at the applicant's request to October 9th. So, but we'll still deal with that when it gets there, but there won't be a public hearing. So, next up on our agenda is the Pledge of Allegiance.
Pledge of Allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the Republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you.
Mr. Chairman, given that today is September 11th, I was wondering if it would be in order for us to have a moment of reflection, remembering the heroic men and women and their families who sacrificed their lives in the name of public safety at the unfortunate events in New York City 6 years ago to the date. So.
Thank you. Next up is public comments. This is a public comment period for things that are not on tonight's agenda. So if you had something you wanted to bring up to the board before we get into our regular agenda, now would be the time. Yes, Ms. Quox. I'm not sure if we have any extras.
We have some extras. I can run some.
All right. Is there any other public comments?
Can we wait till we see the agendas?
Yeah, that's fine. All right, while we're waiting for that, I'll come back to it. After that will be a review and approval of minutes, so I'd say let's skip to that. And does anyone have any changes, amendments, adjustments? If not, do I hear a motion?
Okay. On page 10, the motion for acceptance of the lot consolidation and revised condominium site plan, it should be, the motion should read, Robert Prime made a motion to accept the application as substantially complete with the revisions recommended by the town planner being put on the plan.
All right.
And that's all I had, Mr. Chairman.
All right. And I will admit I did not get an opportunity to read these over, so I will be abstaining from the vote. So any other amendments to the minutes? All right. Would someone like to make a motion?
Make a motion. The meeting, the minutes of the last meeting are accepted and amended.
All right. Do I hear a second?
I'll second.
Seconded by Chip. Is there any further discussion about the minutes? With that, all those in favor of approving the minutes as amended, please signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Those opposed? And I will abstain. And we're still waiting for our agendas. So I'm just gonna take a. Do we have anything else that we can hop to quickly?
Talk about
okay, I leave that to you.
Just a reminder that if you'd like to go to the Office of Energy and Planning Fall Conference that's coming up, it's going to be held at Loon Mountain. This year, please get your registration materials to me and we'll send in a check and get you signed up. Also, the local government center is having their municipal law series again, which is a three-part series. And if you'd like to attend that, we can sign you up for that as well. So,
when's the conference?
I thought it was November 13th or something. November.
It was sent out with our packets last time.
I don't have it.
I don't have it in front of me. I will send you an email. It's in October, November.
Is it? And as always, I've gone to a couple of them. They've been greatly helpful, so I'd encourage anyone to go. I know I will not be able to go. All right. Let me see. Is there any concerns or other business that anyone wants to bring up that can be dispensed with rather quickly? All right. And what we're waiting for is we're just trying to get some agendas so that you guys can see what's on the agenda. If there is public comment not relating to something on the agenda, please feel free to raise your hand and come on up and give a comment. All right. I think I'm just going to move on with the agenda, and we can redress the public comments afterwards. So, first up on the docket tonight is consideration for applicants for alternate planning board member. And I believe we only got one application that I saw. That was for Mr. Jerry Hamill. And I see Jerry's here. Do you want to step up to the podium and just give us a little background, say hi? And okay.
Jerry Hamill, lived in town since 1970. Guess I'm a carpetbagger. I was on the planning board, I think I was elected for four terms on the planning board, 86 to 98, I think, something like that, anyways. Was on the council 2002 this year, I think, or 2001, two terms. And somebody asked me to put my name in for an alternate seat, and here I am. So,
does anyone have any questions for Jerry? I've known him through his position on the council. So.
Yeah, Jerry, would there be opportunities for you to step down if you were an alternate member because of your past business associations with developers in town?
Well, just like any of you, you got to step down. I've always done it. If there was a conflict, I stepped down. I probably stepped down more than most people did, but I mean, you people have to step down if you have a conflict. So, yeah, that's the way it's done.
Thank you.
Yeah, I mean, I don't question your judgment about whether you would step down or not. I was just curious. I know you do a lot of business in town, and I wasn't sure if that might be something where you'd be stepping down so often that it might be frustrating to you and the board to not have you available. But that's completely your call, not ours. Or in my opinion, that's your call.
I think I probably stepped down. Anytime I had to step down, I would guess that probably there were a lot of people that should have stepped down that didn't. It isn't always developers that you right. are talking about that cause a conflict.
Yep. But. Is there any other questions, comments?
Yep. Jerry, could you give me a quick explanation on how you could help this planning board in this community if you were to become an alternate?
I guess I've got some background in as far as the planning board goes. I'm pretty familiar with town given my type of work. I guess I'd probably do as much as any of you people could do, I guess.
I mean, my opinion is that Jerry, I think as opposed to a lot of us, has a lot of site experience, which I would deem invaluable. So I think that Jerry would be a good addition because of that. I know as much as I'd like to believe that I know what kind of site work goes on and how it's best to go on, I think you might provide some better insight into it. So that's my opinion. Other questions, comments? All right. Yep.
How long is this term for?
Is it a one-year?
It would be until the next election, so it would be till May, as far as I understand. Well, no, I guess he's an alternate, so it would be...
It was a one, a two, and a three-year term. George has volunteered to the one.
Didn't we tell you you got the three?
I was asked that question, and there was a two and a three-year spot, and so the shortest one was the two. That's the one I asked for, yeah.
All right, and I mean, I think the process from here, and someone correct me if I'm wrong, is we make a motion to add Jerry on as a alternate member, and if approved, he would then become an alternate for 2 years. So, all right, does that sound mm-hmm. correct?
You have to be sworn in.
Yeah, you definitely have to be sworn in.
And then it does the town hall to be sworn in.
Yep. Is there anyone with questions or want to make a motion? Is there a second? I'll make the second to add Jerry Hamill as an alternate member. And discussion, questions, comments? All right. Hearing none, I'll call for the motion is to approve Jerry Hamill as an alternate member of the planning board for a term of 2 years. All of those in favor, please signify by saying aye. Aye. Those opposed?
Aye.
Aye.
All right. Motion fails. All right. And those who abstain, I guess. Sorry.
Yeah.
Sorry, Jerry.
That's all right.
Jerry.
And so I guess the search continues for more people for being an alternate. And at this point, do we have agendas out in the hallway?
Roseanne has
passed around,
around copies. And
all right.
Thank you, Roseanne.
So I'll reopen the public comment period again. This is just for things that are not on the agenda for tonight. So if anyone has any public comment, please feel free to stand up to the podium now.
I would just like to hand Michael a branch some paperwork.
Thank you.
Oh, okay, thank you.
That would make us perfect. That's what we had to do for last year, and that's what we ended up doing. So there's a lot of corners being cut.
All right. Any other public comment? Seeing none, I close the public comment period. And let's move into our next application, which is Real Estate Advisors, Inc., public hearing for an application for preliminary conceptual consultation at 2 Elm Drive, 1 Elm Street, 1 through 3 Elm Court, Tax Map U2, lots 243, 248, 249, Zone B1. The proposal is to discuss options for development of the above-mentioned lots. And is there a representative?
All right, for those of you who I haven't introduced myself already, I'm Cole Adams. I'm 16. I'm a junior at Phillips Exeter Academy. And I am one of 17 owners via trust of Real Estate Advisors Incorporated. It's owned by myself and a number of my cousins and siblings, all grandkids. And I have been working all summer, pretty much, on this meeting. On discussing options for this drive, which we feel for this property, which we feel is underutilized under the current zoning, and according to RSA 674:1, the planning board may, from time to time, recommend to the local legislative body amendments of the zoning ordinance or zoning map or additions thereto. And it's basically in that capacity that I come to you to basically not request that you change it, but bring to your attention the fact that this property is underutilized both for the town's purposes and for our company. So in this packet is just an accumulation of a number of documents. We've actually been in correspondence with Diane Hardy since October about this issue, discussing essentially what the town is interested in doing with the property. Now, as you mentioned in the introduction, it's zoned in the B1 zone, which permits no residential uses whatsoever, even though the property is surrounded by residential uses. And if you refer to under correspondence, under the purpose of the B1 district, the purpose reads, "The purpose of this district shall be to provide areas suitable for businesses which serve the community and or people passing through town on Route 108. It is further intended that these businesses be segregated from residential uses to prevent conflict and undue impact on residents by business development." Now, I'm new to this whole thing, but my understanding of how the town works is that the planning board and the town council sets the zoning, and then we as developers build within the restrictions of that zoning. Now, before I go on, it should be important to note the previous owner of the property received a variance to put 8 units of elderly housing, 62 and above, sorry. And we felt that the 62 and above age limit is just too restrictive, and it still underutilizes the lot. So right here, this is, if you refer to the back, the last section of this document has the permitted uses in the town. And this is just kind of a visual aid. So what we've done here is we've highlighted all of the permitted uses within our zone and photographed a similar oriented business in the town of Newmarket primarily. And it might be one from Durham, but no, I think they're all Newmarket. So here are basically the options. We have a daycare of any size, according to zoning. We have a hotel, a health club, which we photographed, Great Bay Athletic Club, a retail, that's the Ace Hardware, office space, we took that down at Doucette Survey, where we get all our surveys done, light manufacturing, automotive repair, cultural use, place of assembly, or educational facility. So we felt that that was indicative of, you know, what the property is currently able to be used for. Our goal for the property is to have something that's to find a use for it that, first of all, is compatible with the neighbors and what the neighbors want and what the abutters' interests are, and that it's compatible with the surrounding environment, that it's not an eyesore, that it works. Secondly, we feel that it should be important that it provides the most possible tax benefit to the town within reason, as in, you know, you don't put 2,000, you know, you don't put a 200 unit building in the middle of a suburb, but we feel that it's important for the town to have a benefit from the property. Thirdly, we feel that the property should provide a benefit to the downtown area, which we feel that this lot is in a prime position to do so, because it's right within walking distance of both the library and all the businesses downtown. So finally, we need this project or whatever we end up doing to be economically viable for our company to pursue. Now, I don't know what you guys have seen on this issue or not. I'm not aware of what you've been sent or what exactly you know. So I'll just take a couple minutes here to take any questions or concerns you had, or I just want to get a feel for what you guys know about this issue.
I just want to mention that I have provided each of the board members okay. with a copy of your PowerPoint presentation
oh,
that
excellent.
You sent me with 3 different options.
Okay, so they have that.
Yeah, right. And also there was an earlier email that we received from Walt Sr.
Mm-hmm.
that sort of outlined what the ideas were.
Right, I believe that's actually in that packet as well I just gave you, so they have a couple copies. I guess right now I just wanted to get a feel for what you guys think. Does anyone have anything off the top of their head, anything they'd like to say?
Yeah, I would suggest that you don't refer to the planning board as you guys.
Oh, sorry, sir.
Thank you.
Planning board.
I mean, my initial opinions of this are that right now there's a lot of changes going on with the downtown project, the Mills project. And obviously we've purchased the parking lot directly across from this. my opinion would be that at this juncture, it's somewhat early to be considering a zoning change. Once we see what's happening there and the state of things after all of this change, I think then it would be very appropriate for us to be looking at a zoning change. Before that, I'm not sure it's what we want to do. It's not a good way of planning, in my opinion, and that's where I fall on this. But and I also think that given the circumstances of the change in the downtown, it also behooves you as the developer to consider that this might be a much more valuable and easier changed lot afterwards. You'll know what people down there want. There's going to be a large influx of residential people in the downtown area, and I think once you see what's happening down there and what sort of revitalization there might be happening, that it might benefit you as a developer to see what makes sense to put in then, rather than rushing to put up some housing that will be competing with what's going to happen down there. So, but that's my opinion. Certainly, if anyone else on the board wants to voice an opinion, now would be the time.
I just have a problem with the density of the housing unit that you're proposing.
The
number. I think it's a lot of housing for that particular area. It's already a pretty congested area. It's only going to get more so.
Oh, if you're referring to the
drawings.
The renderings, yes. Yeah. I am 16. I'm new to this. I just looked at the property and thought, you know, let's think outside the box. What can we do? In my honest opinion, those buildings, those two towers, would be extremely expensive to build. We estimate like $6 million a building. And based on my experience with our company, I don't think we can actually afford to do that. So those were just really conceptual ideas. We're not trying to get you to like them. We're not trying to propose those specifically. We were just attempting to bring up this issue because we felt that the uses permitted would be contrary to the neighborhood. So for instance, if we went in and we wanted to put a hotel there, we didn't feel like a hotel would mesh with the neighborhood very well. So rather than do that, we wanted to come to you and get your opinion. But I just wanted to, you know, I just want to reemphasize that we have no intention of, I mean, those are literally just pictures. We have no plans, no nothing. So it's still completely open at this point. And as far as a time and waiting to see, we are willing to work with the planning board, willing to work alongside it in a reasonable amount of time. And what a reasonable amount of time is, you know, a couple months. Maybe, but at some point we're going to have to put something on this lot. It's just that, I mean, I look at it and I think it's a prime piece of real estate for something. Don't know what yet, but we're going to have to do something. And as to your question about the density, if you look, let's see here, is it in correspondence? Abutters. Neighborhood, my bad. In that little section, I have a tax map with the lot we're primarily talking about, which is 2 Elm Drive, U2-243. The other two lots we're not really changing them. We're not interested in changing the existing structures there. Maybe maintenance and bringing them up to maybe better aesthetic standards, but it's really focusing on that lot 243. Those lots in orange I've highlighted are the abutters, and on the next page I've calculated the residential density of those surrounding lots on the residentially developed areas. Found it to be about 12.1875 units per acre. And since this property isn't zoned in a residential district, I felt that if it was pursued to rezone it, it would be benefit to know that information. And if you have looked over the letter I sent, I actually say that the surrounding density is 18. That was due to a miscalculation. And I actually had been including some other lots in that we kind of pared down our focus a little bit. If you look on in that abutter section, you'll see that I've compiled, we sent a survey out to all of our abutters to get their opinion. And that big fold-out spreadsheet is just kind of a matrix of all of their responses. And I thought that that would also be pertinent to this discussion. You guys, if the planning board would like to look at that. Let's see. I also, if you'd like to take just a few minutes, or if you prefer, I just go on. I just thought that that would provide some perspective on the whole thing.
Mr. Chairman?
Yes.
May I speak? Congratulations. You've done a lot of homework. You're obviously interested in doing yeah. and getting involved with this, and I applaud you. There's just a couple of things. I think in kind of reinforcing what Chairman Prine said a moment ago, there's an awful lot going to happen, both downtown and with the mill redevelopment, that is going to change the way we look at the town, or at least the impact and the things that are necessary. And I think when you talk about a two-month time frame for wanting to get underway, just my opinion, and obviously I don't control your thoughts, but I think it's awfully ambitious for you to go ahead and just kind of set the tone with a corner lot, which, by the way, is a cornerstone lot as far as I'm concerned. It's a very important lot. That library gives an image when you drive in or out of the town along 108. And I think that the whatever's developed across the street should give another quality image of the town. And I want to see that happen. I realize that the land belongs to you and your company, and I realize that within the framework of the present zoning and whatever exceptions have been granted, you can go ahead and develop it in accordance with that. If you want different things, then you come to us as you have and propose something when your ideas become a little more, shall we say, gelled. But I think that just a suggestion, because it far be it from me to try and tell you what to do, but I think you really, to maximize your investment here, you should take a look at what happens downtown in both the mill and the downtown redevelopment before you step forward with something that may be completely out of sync and may be competing with things that are done in a much more economical manner.
Right, and I think that is very good advice. When I say 2 to 3 months time frame, I don't mean that we want to start building in 2 to 3 months, but I feel like sometimes this can get caught up in red tape, and just not, I mean, it's a very busy schedule, obviously. And I just, really, by the end of this meeting, I just wanted to know where the planning board stood as far as not a possible development, but just on the general question of whether or not this is zoned in the right district. I think that has to be taken care of before we talk about what specifically is going to go up there, because as I said earlier, I don't know, and we just don't know yet, and that's going to be largely dependent on what we do with the zoning. And I'd just like to quote once from chapter 10 of the master plan, future land use implementation. This is referring to the board's responsibilities. And not that I'm trying to tell you, but just what your responsibility is, but just for reminder. The board must examine the existing zoning scheme in terms of its relationship to the type of development it will likely promote and its consistency with the overall policy towards growth management. And I would agree with the statement that we should wait to see, or at least give deference to what's going on with the downtown. But I feel that this is an important thing, and this question of what do we want to encourage to be built there is completely defined by the zoning. So in theory, we could come to you with a proposal to build any of those options at the next meeting. And I think that I'm not saying, well, we need to do this right now, but it's clearly I feel that regardless of what goes on downtown, the question of what the planning board wants to encourage on this property is just as pertinent now as it would be 6 months from now, because it's just a question of the utilization of the property, and we really don't want to put an eyesore in the cross with the library, like you said. We don't want to do that, but that's why we've come to you. Essentially, I want to get your vision for the property, because we know that the old planning board said it was B1, and we want to get the new planning board's vision. And what I'm hearing from you all is that we want to wait, we want to wait and see what the downtown does. And I think that that is certainly a route. But I just think that if I can impress on you that it is worth considering. But if it is your opinion that we should just wait, then I think we can work with that. But are there anything else?
Thanks, Cole. I appreciate the work that you're doing. You've done a good job. I wouldn't have been able to do the same at your age. So I think my point is just that you bring up good points, and in a conventional town where we're rather stagnant, we probably would look at this and say it might be time to look at some zoning changes. I think my point is only that there's a whole lot of change happening there, and I think that change is going to actually make that zoning make a whole lot more sense than you're seeing it make right now. So, you know, my idea of waiting is only that when we see what does happen there, and even if you got approved today for some reason, you're not going to have buildings up there in a number of years, or in a year probably. So I think if you wait a little bit, you'll see that zoning becomes a more appropriate zoning. And I think that at that time, it'll probably be the best case for you as well. So I would be very hesitant at this point to consider changing the zoning there. And I think that's what we're seeing from a lot of people. Even in your survey that you provided us with, your neighbors and abutters are also resistant to seeing any sort of zoning there. None of them mentioned residential as something that they would like to see. So that's my opinion on the matter.
Yeah, I have a question. You mentioned earlier in your presentation that the previous owner achieved some variances. Who was the previous owner?
A man by the name of Marcel Blanchette, who we worked with to get that whole deal approved. And I think at the time we wanted to get it approved for 55 and older, but there was some resistance on the zoning board as to that. They wanted it 62 and older. We feel like that market is just too small, that it will be tough, it will be very difficult to get those units rented or sold. So
presumably you're going back to amend the variances, is that correct?
We may not. That was the purpose of this meeting, was to see if I see what your input was.
Well, I can give you some input. I can tell you that the people who have telephoned me, who have emailed me, and who have talked to me personally have absolutely no interest and will not support any zoning changes in there at this time. Absolutely not.
Diane, you have
that's account. Feedback from the voters here.
I just have some information to share with the board, if I may. In July 2002, there were 4 variances which were granted for that piece of property, and it was to accommodate an 8-unit townhouse development. And the first variance allowed for residential use within that zoning district, B1 district, for age-restricted housing for folks over age 62. The second variance allowed a density of 2 units per acre because residential isn't permitted in that area, so there had to be some kind of density provided. The third variance was to allow a 75-foot setback from the Lamprey River. A good portion of the property is within the shoreline protection zone, and we have setback requirements that apply. And typically it's a 125-foot setback. And the zoning board at the time granted the 75-foot setback with the condition that there be no cutting of trees within that buffer area. And the fourth variance was for frontage along the river. Under the current zoning and the zoning that was in effect at that time, you had to have at least 150 feet of frontage on the river per unit in order to meet the shoreline protection ordinance requirements. And this particular lot only had 363 feet of frontage. And I just wanted to mention for the planning board's benefits that variances run with the land and do not terminate. However, if the conditions upon which the variance was granted or the representations that were made by the applicant at the time have changed or the overall plan has changed, then it would require that the zoning board revisit the application and grant additional variances to reflect the new proposal. I also wanted to mention that there was a site plan that was drawn up in response to this previous proposal. However, that has lapsed, so that if the applicant wants to go forward with development, even under the existing variances that have been received, then they still have to come back to the planning board with a site plan that meets our current requirements, because the approval didn't go forward because active and substantial development had not occurred. So I just wanted to mention that just for your information, so you have that.
So if they came forward with a new site plan for our approval, they would, would the variance still, I mean, it was the same?
Same plan.
The variances would still hold?
That's correct. And they do not terminate.
But if he was to put the two towers in, those variances would not hold?
Those, that's correct. He'd have to go back to the zoning board and convince them otherwise that it was appropriate.
Is there any other questions, comments from the board? Yes, Janice?
This is just feedback for you, Adam, correct?
Cole.
I'm thinking Adam for some reason.
It happens. Everybody
does that.
This
is a conceptual meeting,
yeah,
so
I know.
Just feedback.
Right. Just feedback. When and if the time comes and you develop the property, I'm hearing from a lot of people, and I know as a member of the planning board, I would want this also. You would have to go in front of the advisory heritage board, which wouldn't be a bad idea if you maybe talk to them now, because that whole area has some beautiful historic homes. And I think the people who live in that area, when the time comes when you do your development, would want something to reflect the character of that. I call it the village, okay? The homes on that, whatever your condos. And another thing is, if a tower ever goes up, I don't know if people, how I would be against a tower, but anything over three stories, the town of Newmarket doesn't have a ladder truck. Okay, you will have to work with the fire department very closely, because I would like to see, not just for you, for any developer who comes in who's going to have anything above three stories, contribute to a CIP towards a ladder and aerial truck. So, because right now we don't have a truck that goes over the three stories, and I won't get into a lot of it for you because it gets into insurance, but the closest towns that have ladder trucks are within 20 to 24 minutes away. And if there was ever a fire, I mean, the mills are going to have to solve this, look at this
sure
problem too.
Fire,
yeah, but by the time they get here, it's about 20 minutes.
Okay.
I got those facts from the fire department.
Okay.
But those are just some concerns that I think you should have in your mind. So when you go back, you can keep those thoughts.
Thank you.
Yep, you're welcome.
As Mr. Chairman said, this is totally preliminary.
Yep.
So I appreciate all of your help. So the feeling I'm getting is just wait and see what the downtown revitalization has to do with the property. And I think that's a valid approach, and I'd like to thank you all for listening to me. Thank you all for giving me your time. So.
And I think before you leave, I want to at least open it up to the public so that you can get some public comment.
Sure.
And again, I remind the public that this is a non-binding meeting, and you're speaking to me, not to Mr. Adams. So, all right. I saw Roseanne's hand come up, and if you can step down, Cole.
Yeah, no problem.
Thank you. And of course, please state your name and address for the record.
Roseanne Quox, 332 Wadley Falls Road, Newmarket. I think he's doing a great job for his age. Just a few things, Mr. Chair. Is this going to be done under it said elderly housing?
That was the previous application, was an elderly housing application. Was this plan to be elderly or just straight housing?
Well, we feel that elderly housing provides the best benefit to the town.
Right.
And we put together spreadsheets on that.
Okay.
So, yeah, right. Probably.
So there you go.
So then elderly housing, the only elderly housing ordinance we have in town is the affordable elderly housing, am I correct? That's the only criteria for affordable elderly housing that we have.
Roseanne, there is another section where elderly housing is permitted. And hold on a minute, I can clarify that for you.
Wasn't that the same impression?
Huh? Bear with me.
Did you have anything further?
A few other things. Like he stated, just to bring a few things out to him, if he does plan on coming back, it's just things that are stated. He quoted the, if it is the elderly housing, that setbacks, if the, shall be 35 feet from all property lines, and that the buffer shall be sufficient to adequately shield the residential abutting properties. But there's also that any conflicts with the character of the adjacent properties will be minimal in terms in, of the size and bulk of the visible buildings. So it would have to be, if he planned on doing something that big, it would probably, according to the regs here, it would have to be sufficiently secluded so as to minimize negative impacts to the abutting properties. And then he also...
Hold on one second, Roseanne.
Sure.
George has a comment.
No offense. That's a lot of detail for a conceptual meeting.
That's true,
too. We're trying to get ideas, and yeah. I think Mr. Adams here was just trying to get a trying to get ideas, general ideas on the concept and to get a feel for what people wanted. And we're getting down to as if this is a plan that we're trying to assess and it is. And so I think,
right.
No offense, the time for faith and the length of the agenda.
Yeah, that's a good point.
Yeah, but certain things that weren't touched upon either by the planning board or him should be of interest and would be helpful to him.
Right. And I
think he plans on doing.
I agree, Roseanne, and just like any other developer, he's going to have to look at the ordinance and see how his development fits in. And I, you know, obviously you're going to have to take a look at that. Roseanne brings up a good point about the elderly ordinances, and you'll have to
it's very
check
specific.
Those out and see how they fit. So
because I know it's very specific as to what can be built there under what criteria,
yep.
The certain state and federal regulations,
yeah,
and the master plan also states a section in there that we have an appropriate amount of multi-units in town as compared to residential, and that's something the master plan's looking at. These are just all things that would be helpful to him in anything he wants to take before any board.
Right.
That would be good for him to look into. There's more, but I won't take up any more time.
Thank you.
Okay.
And Bruce, I saw your hand up.
Yeah.
You
sure?
Yeah, I'm pretty sure. I'd like to make an exception for you, Bruce.
Just
but
a question. It seemed that previous applications, they changed the setbacks for the shoreline protection.
They gave a variance to the setback.
They gave a variance for that. And being part of the Conservation Commission, I would, you know, like the board to reconsider that type of
I don't believe that
variance.
We can't actually reconsider the variance. However, I'm curious, and I don't honestly know, but with the shoreline protection laws changing, that might actually negate the variance, would be my thought. I'm not sure.
Because
it would be a new law. So
I would like to see the boards be a little bit more stringent with the setbacks.
I think in the future we would
because
be.
Because of problems we've had in the past.
Yeah, and that was the ZBA. We actually
and if we have a chance to reinforce them now would be a good time to do it.
Yep.
And maybe we'd have less flooding going on.
Yeah, I don't disagree. Diane?
I just wanted to clarify on the zoning. The Affordable Elderly Housing District is an overlay district for the R1, R2, and R3 residential districts. In addition to that, age-restricted housing is permitted by use in the M1, M2, and M3 district. So there are a few more options.
Great. Dana?
Just going to be a question, actually, for Dana Glennon, 2 Beach Street, Newmarket. This gentleman, Mr. Cole.
Dana, you need to address me.
Okay, I'm sorry. I was wondering if I could have a copy of the orange book, if he had an extra one. As a member of the ZBA board, I kind of like to get abreast of that.
Diane will get you a copy of one
copy
of ours.
Thank you.
Thank you. Is there any other public comment, sir?
Buzz Dieterle, 4 Smith Garrison Road. About 20 years ago, I did a stint on the planning board and have some familiarity with what Grandpa did in the old days. And I remember one incident in very particular where he came to us and he knew more about our regulations than we did, and we ignored him, and he wound up with an approval that made everybody very unhappy.
I can't hear you.
That made everybody very unhappy because he knew more about our ordinances than we did. I'm detecting that the planning board is going to sit back on this and let him work out something and come back to you folks. I would strongly urge you to take advantage of this and be proactive, working with him to develop any possible changes, to assign somebody to this, and so that this doesn't come back when Grandpa knows more about the ordinances than we do.
I think your point is very valid, and I understand your point. At this point, we're at a conceptual. So the exact purpose of this is to sort of stand back, look at what he's coming with, give him some ideas so that he can develop what it is that he wants to do. Then he'll come back to us with a plan, and that's when we really get down and dirty with the plan.
Right, and that's where I'm respectfully disagreeing with you. I'd rather you not sit back and wait for him to come back. I'd rather that you folks develop a relationship with him now, which was a mistake Newmarket made with his grandfather.
Right, and I agree with you. However, this is what's allowed by the state RSA. They allow us to have a conceptual review for the purpose of taking a quick look, giving some ideas. When he comes back with a plan is the first time that we can actually start working with the plan. We can't work with
again, I would respectfully disagree that you can informally work with him from the day he walks out the door.
Well, and to some extent, Diane's been doing that.
Okay.
So.
I think we also have to be mindful that we need to be looking at the zoning in that downtown area in a comprehensive way. We shouldn't just be focusing on one particular piece of property or a grouping of properties, because that could amount to spot zoning. We obviously have some other tracts within the downtown area that have potential for redevelopment, and we should be looking at them as a cohesive unit. Yeah. And I'm not suggesting
for a minute that you single this development out, but I'm strongly suggesting that it be integrated into your overall planning strategy.
Absolutely.
You know they're in a hurry to do something with this, maybe not 2 months, maybe 6 months. You know that at some point in the next year they're probably going to come in with something, and I'm just urging you to be proactive in taking advantage of that rather than waiting for them to walk in the door cold turkey with another conceptual. And the other thing that I would point out, I would just add, as a resident of town for a long time, we desperately need senior housing. I would prefer that we not see rental senior housing. I would prefer that we see purchased senior housing, i.e. condominiums, townhouses, not more apartments.
I hear what you're saying, and I appreciate your comments. Diane points out that we can't regulate whether or not they're rentals or purchases, so that's one thing we do have to be careful as we walk down the line. What's that?
A little horse trading.
Yeah. So, is there other public comment? Yes, sir.
I'm Martin McKenzie from 6 Washington Street, and I just have a very quick aesthetic observation to make. Somebody mentioned that this is right by the library, which is a town landmark, and it's important that we take that into consideration. It's also, if I understand it, it's positioned right on the Lamprey River, north of the Main Street Bridge. Any five-story structure there would permanently affect what is now a really pristine and beautiful view up the Lamprey from there. I hope that that remains a consideration for the board.
Absolutely. Thank you.
Thank you.
Is there other public comment? All right, seeing none, I will close the public comment period. And if there's anything further from the board, Chuck?
One thing hasn't been mentioned, Adam, is the fact is that as you're doing your planning, take a look at the wastewater plant in terms of you're going to add. Let's say you're going to put in two 20-unit towers. That's 40 homes. And if you're going to do that, you should double-check and see how the wastewater plant's going to be affected by it. Also, the water itself. This is just to give you an idea to thinking through it.
Thank you. Judy.
The only other thing I would say is that we already have zoning, and there are things you can put there. It's not as if you can't use that property. There are many choices. They're not what you maybe want to do, but there are other choices. I would say, in light of everything, stick with the zoning we have for now. You know, work within that framework. And in the future, it might change, but we can't you know, we can't see the future. We have to wait till we get there.
Yeah, I mean, I think that echoes my point, which was just, you know, right now it doesn't make a whole lot of sense for us to change the zoning there because we don't know what's going to happen there in a handful of years. And when we get there, you might find that there's an even better use that suits both you and Newmarket in a much better way. So, again, I think you, Peter, has a comment.
I want to let you know I sympathize with you. I, too, have two first names. Yes. And I get it all the time. So, I think you probably can gather that the feeling is you don't want something that is, look at me, look at me. We would like to have something that is, I would like to, I'll speak for myself. I would like to see something that is aesthetically pleasing. It fits with the character and the nature of the property. It doesn't dwarf or outshine everything around it just for the sake of doing that. And something that you can be proud of when you as you grow and you do other projects and so forth, that you can look back and say, hey, this was a good project I did. That's it.
And along those lines, I can tell you from personal experience, when you see something that you helped design actually come into play in your hometown, and it's something that you appreciate, it's a pretty good feeling. So keep that in mind. And with that, I'd say that we're done with that application, and we look forward to working with you. And certainly questions and comments should go through Diane in the future, and we'll see you.
Thank you.
Oh, sorry. Diane points out that we have some comments that were sent to us, I believe.
Well, actually, it's a memo from
Dan. From Dan, yep. Sure, if you want to just hit the high points, I think we're getting an idea of what's looked for here, but sure. This is a memo, I'm assuming you probably got it forwarded to you, from Dan Vincent, our building official.
He's provided some photographs of some historic structures here in Newmarket that he feels you may want to take a look at and try to model the architectural design after some of the landmarks that are currently in Newmarket, so that it has more of a Newmarket feeling. He goes on to say that while the rezoning occurred, this lot was included in the B1 district. Its anticipated development in the town may not be the best use of the lot today. This has been proven true by recent board's decisions to permit residential housing. Whatever the vision may have been for vacant lots and their development, we look to the master plan, the site review regulations, and the zoning ordinance for guidance. The theme of these documents as they relate to land development encourages the enhancement of the built environment, the building of neighborhoods, and preserving our historical past. It would appear from standing at this location with a view of the surrounding structures that the architecture required for any new structure would be significantly reproduced by what we see in the existing structures. In conclusion, it would be my opinion that 3 to 4 duplex structures be constructed to reflect the size, type, and architectural features represented by the enclosed photographs. And we can make those available to you, Cole, if you'd like to use them in your planning efforts.
And I think the last point I would make is it would not be a bad idea to at least consult with the Heritage Advisory Commission before you get too far. We do value their input strongly, and it would only be a good idea for you. So, thank you.
Thank you.
Great. All right. Next up on our agenda is Cheney Properties Management Corp. continuation of a public hearing for consideration of minor subdivision application, including a lot consolidation and revised condominium site plan, located on Exeter Road, Tax Map U4, lots 11, 12, and 13. The proposal is to consolidate Tax Map U4, lots 11, 12, and 13 into one lot, thereby adding an area that currently comprises lots 12 and 13 into the Newmarket Business Park condominium. And let me just quickly review what we've done so far. This is strictly about the lot consolidation of that area. This is not about the proposed development. At this point, we've accepted this application to be under our jurisdiction. We will hear what Mr. Michaud has to say today. And they have continued to request that we do not approve this until such time that the development would be approved. So Mr. Michaud.
Good evening. My name is Steve Michaud from Doucette Survey. I think you gave a pretty good synopsis of where we stand at this point. Since our last meeting, I've submitted revised plans to the Planning Department addressing the concerns that Ms. Hardy had, and I'm happy to go through those if you like.
Please.
We added a notation for the total new frontage of proposed Lot 11. We added the addition of the SCS soil types to the plan. We added some clarification to a couple of notes, specifically note number six, and revised some spelling errors in a couple of notes. We've also provided the Planning Department with a draft copy of a revised condominium declaration provided by my client's attorney for your legal counsel's review.
I don't seem to have a copy of this, but does everyone else?
No. It was my thought that this would be on the agenda for continuation through the next date, because okay. It's going to be, you know, moving along a parallel track with the other that's been submitted by Mr. Serino. I have reviewed the plans that Mr. Michaud provided us, and he has met all the conditions that we set forth in the acceptance vote. However, there was one thing I wanted to make sure it doesn't get overlooked, and that is that we would like to make sure that this plan references the other plan that's before the planning board and vice versa. And I thought we were going to add a note to that effect, Steve, and I didn't see that. And I just want to make sure we don't overlook that in the final plan.
I will add that note.
So I guess I would recommend that we continue this to the next meeting.
All right.
And that it be considered simultaneously with the other application.
And I agree it should be considered simultaneously, and I think you do too. If you wanted to run through what has changed, that's up to you. If not, we can continue this at
there
this time.
There haven't been any substantive changes to the plan. My only thought on continuance is I would actually prefer a conditional approval, only from the standpoint that this application, if it received conditional approval, wouldn't have to be back before the board. In other words, my client wouldn't have to pay for me to come back every month to sit in the audience and observe.
All right.
We would still request that it not be formally approved until such time as the next site plan application was approved.
Yeah, I mean, I think that's certainly doable. I think you're going to see a lot of hesitation to do it, but I leave it up to the board for their opinions on the matter. Does everyone understand what he's requesting? Well, I see Mike has his hand up, so all right, Mike.
I'm just questioning now. It's my understanding that after the conditional approval, the board has so many days to finalize that, correct?
I think that's true. However, if they weren't willing to give us an extension on that, it would then turn into a denial, which wouldn't help them any. So, I mean, we have that carrot hanging over their heads. So, are there other questions? Chet, are you? All right.
Yeah, I'm not clear what the conditional approval. I mean, if you're giving a conditional approval to the application, what's the condition?
This would be a conditional approval. This is my understanding. This would be a conditional approval of the lot line revision and re-subdivision of this lot into the business park. And the condition would be that the other application be approved.
So, in essence, it's an approval, because if we approve the next one, there's no need to come back. This right. one automatically gets approved.
Yep.
Just so the board understands yep. that they're, in essence, approving the lot line if the other one gets approved.
Right.
The lot line adjustment, excuse right. me. Okay. I just want to have clarity there.
Yep. Correct. And for the people out in the audience, this isn't approving the site as a whole. This is just approving the change of the lot lines.
Correct. So. And just to back up to last month, my client does not wish for this to be approved unless the site plan is approved.
Right.
So they're tied together in that nature.
So if we approve the lot line adjustment, we must approve the site.
No, we don't have to approve the site. We can deny it, but this lot line adjustment would only happen if the site were approved. So it would be contingent upon that happening.
Right.
This is just approving the lot line adjustment.
So a note needs to be put on the plan that clarifies that relationship between this and the other plan. And that would have to be one of the conditions of approval if the board chose to.
And I won't submit a final plan until the other site plan has been approved.
Right. That can be done administratively.
Yep. Right. All right, and I'm just going to quickly open it up to public comment. So if there's any public who has comments or questions about this, Dana,
could you speak in the mics? We can't hear you back here.
Okay, yeah, I'm not sure. Is it any better when we're in the mics? I'm not sure it's been on.
Sorry.
Yeah.
Okay.
Thank you.
Thank you. Sorry. Yes, sir.
My name is Al Knight. I live on 59 Exeter Street. I recommend that the board reject this. Not many years ago, the whole concept of the business park condominiums came up, and it was sold as mostly a business park, not a fast food restaurant park. And this would, allowing it on its own, would put the nose of the camel under the tent for previous other projects, even if this Dunkin' Donuts was also denied. And the aesthetic value, I remember when they built that house across the old La Branch house, that was the most modern and the nicest house in town at the time in the early 50s when that was built. And to have that raised for any reason would really make the street look a whole lot differently. Thank you.
Thank you. Is there other public comment? All right. Seeing none, I close the public comment period and bring it back to the board. Is there any other questions, comments, discussion? If not, is there a motion? I mean, I understand your purpose and your intent, and I am, for some reason, hesitant to conditionally approve this. I can't really tell you why, but
I think we need to wait.
I think so too.
I think we need to wait.
I'm thinking that there might be some easements that might be required and that they should be shown on this plan, and that may not become apparent until we do a detailed look at the site plan. So I would agree with your inclination that we not approve it at this point and that we continue to have it on the agenda at the same time as the other application is being reviewed.
And certainly, whenever it's on the agenda, a simple letter saying, please continue my application is all that's needed. And I understand that's not what you're particularly looking for, but I think we found in the past that when we compartmentalize developments, and even though this has to be by law, it makes it a little bit harder for us to see what's going on, you know, sort of seeing the forest through the trees. So I think it will only be a benefit to us to do it this way, and I understand that causes some extra work on your behalf, but I think it's the most appropriate thing for us at this time. Is that all right? Someone like to make a motion as such? I guess the motion could be to continue this to the next public meeting, which I believe is October 9th.
Mm-hmm. So moved.
All right.
I'll second that.
All right.
Can I just ask the question? Do you foresee with the plan before you any potential changes that might need to be made for next month's meeting, or other than the addition of the note that you referenced?
Yeah, I think that's unless something were to change with the other application where we need to see something else, I don't see that there's anything with this that wouldn't at this point be.
I don't think it is.
Just the lot line adjustment you're talking about.
Yeah, okay. Right. That's all this is.
As far as the overall plan itself, I don't understand know. What you want.
The other part of the plan we'll get to after, but this is just the lot line adjustment at this point. So we have a motion.
Just for maybe this might help to expedite things a little bit. If if you haven't made any changes to the plan at the next meeting, you can just submit a letter to the planning board stating that, and we can move on to the next application without any further discussion, so that you would not have to, you know, physically be here.
Sure, that would work out fine.
Would that work out okay? As a matter of fact, I was surprised to see you here tonight, because I thought we would just dispense with this very quickly and move on to the other application.
I try to be quick.
Okay. Thank you, Steve.
We like to see you, but, you know. All right, so we have a motion and a second to continue this to the next meeting. Is there any other discussion? Seeing none, those in favor of continuing this application to the next meeting, which is October 9th, please signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Those opposed? And those who abstain? Motion carries. Thank you, Steve. Moving right along.
Doing a good job.
All right. Next up on the agenda is Antonio Salima, continuation of public hearing for the acceptance and consideration of an application for site plan for the property located at Exeter Road at the entrance of the Newmarket Business Park, tax map U4, lots 12 and 13, zone B1. The proposal is to construct a Dunkin' Donuts restaurant and a second floor office. Existing structures will be removed. The new building will be two stories, with a 2,490 square foot restaurant and a 2,490 square foot office. The site shall be serviced by municipal water and sewer. We saw this application last month. There was a lot of question about the viability of the traffic and the traffic flow. My impression since then, we have enlisted a engineer to review the site on our behalf, and we have not received the traffic impact from the developer yet, and we got a lighting statement, and it was somewhat incomplete.
Mr. Walden, who's the engineer here this evening, did submit to us a large-scale photometric plan with the lighting details on it prior to the meeting this evening.
Okay, great. And at this point, the floor is yours.
Great, thank you. Good evening. My name is Ben Walden from Attar Engineering. Well, with me tonight is Bill Eaton from Eaton Traffic Engineering and Wendy from Woodburn & Associates. Also with me tonight is Ken Wood, president of Attar Engineering. To start, I'd like to briefly go over the history of how we've got to where we are tonight. Back in February, we came before the board with a sketch plan, and the comments from that meeting was that the board didn't like the loading dock in the front of the building facing 108. They also wanted us to look at making the building parallel to 108. At that point, the building was perpendicular to 108. You also wanted me to look at putting in a decelerization lane for the entrance off of 108, and changing the entrance off of 108 into having just traffic entering from the southbound, eliminating traffic entering from the north, going north. On April 19th, we went before the Technical Design Committee. At that point, the Technical Design Committee suggested that we get a traffic study, which we knew we needed to get. We also were asked to look at a WB50 truck entering and facilitating this lot. At that point, they then also asked us for a landscaping plan. So on May 2nd, we submitted the site plan application for sketch plan, and came before you on the 15th of May. We discussed the traffic again, the entrance from 108, the proximity to the railroad. Parking was discussed. There was very little concern at that point about the parking. There was a lot of discussion about the architectural review on the building, the elevations that were submitted. Stormwater was also discussed, and the existing trees and existing landscaping was discussed. On July 30th, we then submitted a revised plan based on your comments from that meeting. On August 7th, we went before a scoping meeting for New Hampshire DOT. And then we came before you on August 14th, which was the last planning board meeting. From that meeting, I have the notes from Diane Harding, which I'd like to go over at this point if that's where we'd like to go.
Let's do that.
Great. So as part of the introduction, the proposed design of two travel lane drive-through was viewed as problematic as it could result as a traffic backup onto Route 108. Bill Eaton will discuss this a little bit farther in his report, but just to talk about it briefly, the two lanes going around the outside of the building for the drive-through, from a safety standpoint, it's required. If there is a fender bender in there, emergency access to that is essential. The other reason for it, if somebody gets into the drive-through lane and wants to get out, you know, they need that option to continue out of the drive-through. There was concern about having both an entrance off of 108 and the Newmarket Park entrance. It was suggested that the 108 be eliminated. Dunkin' Donuts is interested in this site based on the drive-through traffic coming south on 108 in the morning. You know, that's the main reason, the draw for this site. So without having that entrance off of 108, this site, which is zoned for business, really eliminates the value of it to Dunkin' Donuts. The need for a traffic study to look at both internal and external traffic circulation. Bill Eaton is in the process of doing that. The need for an independent traffic engineer to advise the planning board on traffic-related issues. As was mentioned, the town has hired a outside traffic engineer. The close proximity of the railroad crossing, potential safety hazards. Again, that comes back to Q in the drive-through area. The railroad is shown on our plan. I have a plan here. Showing queued cars entering the drive-through from 108. As noted on here, two cars in the pickup area. 13 cars queued up at a minimum. That's no cars coming in from the parking lot area, from the business park entrance, before you have any issues with traffic out on 108. And I think I'm not the only one here, but if there was anywhere around 6 or 8 cars in queue, I'm probably not going to get into the into the drive-through lane. If I really want my coffee, I'm probably going to go inside. But either way, we're still looking at 13, 14 cars of queue before you get out on the 108. Again, Bill will discuss this in depth further. The architect of the structure and the need for it to be compatible with the character of the neighborhood and the town's image and historic mill community. That was discussed at the last meeting, and there didn't seem to be any real issues on the architectural view of the plans that were submitted. The next comment, that there'd be adequate stormwater management plans with oil grease separators for protection for water quality.
Let me interrupt you for 1 second.
Sorry.
I believe we had suggested that you speak to the Heritage Advisory Committee at the last meeting in respect to the architecture of the building.
And we have sent plans to the Heritage Committee, and we have not heard back. I called yesterday, and
I believe, did we hear back?
Did you get the plans to Judith Ryan, who is the chair of that committee?
Yep, we sent them to the chair's, the address of the chair that was that I got from Diane.
Did you send them to the town hall, though?
Did you send them to her home address?
I sent them to the address that was on that list, and I can dig that out for you if you'd like. I have that with me.
Yeah, Judy's not here. I thought I saw her earlier. But
we have not received anything.
All right. That needs to be obviously remedied.
Contact
yep.
On the agenda.
Yeah, I think that that's, obviously you are going to have to, if need be, send another set of plans to Judy so that, and get on the agenda of the Heritage Advisory Committee so that you can have that review.
Yeah, we'd be happy to do that.
Great.
The plans, and I, okay. Just to continue on, Ken's gonna look for the address that we sent it to just to make sure that that is the correct address. That there'd be adequate stormwater management plans with oil grease separators for protection of water quality.
Excuse me for 1 minute.
Yeah.
This is Judy Ryan, the chair of our Heritage Advisory Committee. Judy, we were just speaking here, and we were trying to figure out if the Heritage Advisory Committee had gotten a copy of the plans for this proposed Dunkin' Donuts.
No, we have not.
Okay. I'm sorry, I forget your name, sir.
Ben Walden.
Sorry, Ben. Ben said that he had sent you a set, so maybe Ben will have to send you another set so that the, and also so that you can be added to, or Ben can be added to your next agenda or the soonest agenda so that you can review those plans. Thank you.
Yes, thank you.
Yes, sir.
Ben, do you have an extra set of plans? Can you hand them to her now?
After the meeting, I'd be happy to give her what I have. I'm not sure I have a full set, but I certainly have.
Okay. Great. Thank you. Sorry for the all the interruptions.
No, that's fine.
Great.
Sorry for the confusion.
No, it's sure. Okay.
So stormwater management. We have submitted a stormwater management plan with our application, and oil and grease separators are identified on the detail sheet and will be used in the project. That the existing old trees and landscaping be maintained to the extent possible. I think Wendy talked about this at the last meeting. There is a significant amount of grade change that's going to be needed to be done in order to facilitate the building and the parking. So unfortunately, I don't believe there will be any way we can save a lot of the internal trees on the project. Certainly some of the trees on the outer edge, we will do our best to save. Completeness of application. The legal owner of record has been addressed on the plan. I have also enclosed a copy of the purchase and sales agreement with the project. The next one, a scale should be in both text and graphic form. The scale is actually in both graphic and scale form. I guess Diane just wasn't used to seeing it on the in the title block, so I've also added it underneath the graphic scale. The signature block should be as stated. The signature block has been updated. In order for plans to record and register deeds of a licensed surveyor, that was the meeting just before this. As part of that, we have also enclosed a set of their plans with our application from Doucette Surveying.
And Diane had a comment and then Peter.
Yeah, I just, we need to make sure that both plans cross-reference each other,
mm-hmm.
and that they're tied together. And I know you've made reference to the plan, but I think it needs to clearly spell out in the notes that this is necessary as part of the two plans are tied together. I'm sorry, I'm not articulating well tonight. And I don't think by just making reference to that other plan, it does that. You need to have a clarification in the note section. And I'd be happy to work with you in drafting some language that achieves that.
Okay, we can do that.
I just didn't feel that it did quite what we wanted it to.
Okay.
Okay.
And Peter, you had a comment?
Ben, 2 points. Early on in your chronological list of the things that were accomplished and faced up to and so
yep.
forth as you came through, you mentioned the aspect of the building having been originally perpendicular to 108 and you were asked to make it horizontal 108. Is that correct?
Correct.
Well, last meeting, I remember Mr. Badger pointed out that the fact that you had the parking in front of the building was a detriment in his and my opinion,
mm-hmm.
and that perhaps you should work on something that would change the aspect of the building. I don't know if we're in conflict with something that was said before, but I think it's a valid point. And then the other thing is, I guess I bristle when somebody says Dunkin' Donuts is going to throw us out if we can't have this particular entrance. I got traffic safety and I got pedestrian safety on my mind, and I really don't care what Dunkin' Donuts thinks of that entrance there. I don't like it, but that's just a personal opinion.
Yeah, fair enough. And I mean, to that point, you actually went so far as to say that as far as Dunkin' Donuts is concerned, this isn't an appropriate lot. And I think you hit the nail on the head there. So but we can continue on. But you know, to me, this is a very inappropriate lot for a Dunkin' Donuts, and I think that there's starting to be some agreement on that.
Yeah, and we very specifically said in the last meeting, and thank you, Peter, for mentioning it, because I would have also, that we suggested very strongly that you consider revising the plan to have the parking in the back and the building in the front. And I don't see anything there like that.
I'm sorry, I didn't mean to interrupt. I'd be happy to talk to you about that.
Well, you'll talk to the board.
I'm sorry. When we had early on in the project, the building was, and I do have a copy of that plan with me if you'd like to look at it. The building was located perpendicular to 108. As also discussed, there is a large grade change between the front and the rear of the project. What that does as far as the building being perpendicular to 108, if the Dunkin' Donuts was to be on the first floor, the drive-through being at the rear of the building, parking being on the side, the drive-through window still needs to be on the first floor. So as the rear of your project determines the height of your first floor, as you go towards 108, you end up with a big grade change. And then, so the front of your building ends up getting extremely tall. The other issue was getting access to that parking area, again, because of the grade change. In order to get access into the building, as you push this grade that's at the rear of the building farther and farther out towards 108, you end up with bigger and bigger drops. So that was the main reason, besides the suggestion from the board that we turn the building parallel to 108. There was some concern about the loading dock being in the front of the building. By turning the building parallel to 108, we were able to move the loading dock to the side of the building.
And you said this was at the February meeting that this happened? Because I honestly,
level.
Okay, because I don't remember any of that.
Yep.
He right. came in and met with the Public Works Director, myself, and the building inspector, and I don't think our town engineer was involved, but it was a preliminary staff level meeting.
Thank you. I thought my mind was going.
Now you're talking about grade changes, and in my mind, and I'm not an engineer or an architect, but those are engineering and architect issues that need to be addressed. And I'm telling you, and I thought we made it plain last meeting, that parking cannot be in front if you want to get this through. So I suggest to the engineers and the architects, you need to figure out how to do that.
Before we jump on saying that there's no possible way that we can look at the parking in the front, Wendy from Woodburn Associates has done a rendering of what this project will look like from 108 once the project is complete. I'd like you to focus on the fact that even though the parking is in the front, because of the grade changes, you see very little of the parking lot from the 108 area. And she will discuss that in a second.
Thank you. And I think you were hitting some of the points of our comments from the last meeting, so you can keep up, George.
I think it was one of your earlier comments. You mentioned that you needed the two lanes for the drive-through.
Mm-hmm.
I think that was in response to something I might have said the last time, which was I think you should make, if you need to keep that southbound lane entrance, that only be a drive-through entrance. That doesn't mean you wouldn't need the two lanes. My
And actually, I would agree at this point, we'd be happy to make that entrance into a drive-through only entrance.
My other concern was the flow, and maybe this is what the traffic engineer will address, is that with those two lanes coming around, somebody who wants to comes in, if it's only for the drive-through, and that's what I'm trying to recollect what my point was, anybody who wants to use the parking lot would have to go in through the main entrance. That's what I'm trying to get to. Because otherwise, you have traffic that may want to go into the parking lot that comes around and has to make a left-hand turn in front of someone on that drive-through lane. And I think that's a poor traffic flow. And it's still that way.
Well, to address that, as you're leaving the drive-through, the curbing bumps out so that there is only one lane here. It is a wider lane, so that you could squeeze two cars together, but it's not comfortable. This would force you into one lane, taking a left.
Still not comfortable with it. I guess it's a potential solution.
Janice had a comment, and then Peter.
I don't know who to address it to, but I have a radical thought. Since the traffic is one of the main issues, why don't we do away with where you want it to come in and go up through where the main driveway is up into the professional park? Now, come in, make a loop behind. You can work with the developer who owns those, and they went with Douglas because you have those other properties, and they can park somewhere else, and then you're coming off up through the main entrance, and they make the loop in and go back out the main entrance instead of coming in off where it is.
I'm not completely positive. I follow you. I guess you're
okay.
You're
you know the main entrance way now going into that professional park?
Yep.
Just get rid of the other one.
Just get rid of what you're doing.
And I think that's what we've been saying.
He said he doesn't want
I remember
that.
The very first meeting that you had at a staff level, it was suggested that you just eliminate that altogether, and there'd just be one entrance in, one entrance out. And that was the staff recommendation from the planner and also from the Public Works Department.
And I think that we've carried that through the conceptual till now, but so. All
right. I don't know. I don't think. Were you clear of that, I was trying to say?
Yes, I think.
The first time
I understand.
I'm clear of it. I haven't heard anyone else use that entrance way before at a public meeting with the public.
Yeah. All right, and Peter had a comment, and then I want to...
Just one more thing. If you're jogging with Donuts or anybody else like that, if you come in from that southbound lane, that separate entrance, okay, and you want to go to the drive-through, as George has suggested that be a drive-through only, or whether it is or not, if you want to go to the drive-through, you've got to cut across the lane that is otherwise an exit lane. You've got to work your way into the flow of traffic that may or may not be heavy at that time, waiting for drive-through. And if you can't get in immediately, and people being what people are, you may not be able to get in for two or three more cars until they get where they want to be. It just seems to me that it's a natural bottleneck. It's a problem. And I don't know why you're hanging on to it so tight.
Down here?
Yeah.
Yeah.
I mean, your only traffic coming in here is going into the drive-through.
Yeah. Point.
But it has to cross a lane that's your exit lane before it can get into the drive-through. Things being slow, it's an automatic queue, so you're always going to be fighting this car to get up into the second lane. I think that's been our opinion all along.
Nobody coming down here to go to the drive-through would be going into the exit lane.
Right, but the people coming out, I guess no one would come down and through, which was originally the idea.
If you're leaving the parking lot, you would take a right here and enter into the business park exit.
Then I guess I'm not seeing a whole lot of purpose for the outer lane at that point. But, besides people who queue and then want to get out of the queue. But
it also facilitates the WB50 truck to get around the site.
All right. And at this point, let's carry on with your response to the comments from our last meeting, and then we'll go back into questions.
Okay.
And comments.
Information regarding the area of the lot, length of the road, frontage is missing. Again, this addresses the subdivision condo plan, which was discussed just prior.
Can we back up for a minute, please? Yep. One of the recommendations was that there be a boundary survey. I know that Doucette has done a survey, but in order for the Register of Deeds to record the site plan, there has to be a land surveyor's stamp on the site plan or else they won't record it. So you need to put the footprint of your design on the boundary plan so that it can be recorded, and you need to have Mr. Michaud stamp it so that we can get that recorded if we get to that point.
Okay, we have to talk to him about that. The legend should include a symbol identifying the building setback line that's been added to the plan. Outdoor lighting, as mentioned, photometrics, and a cut sheet has been presented to the board. Architectural and aesthetic review. We've
addressed that.
We've addressed that. Roads, given the volume of traffic, I'm going to have Bill Eaton discuss the roads at this point.
Okay.
Thank you.
Thank you, Bill. Yeah.
I haven't seen the DOT application. You need to get a copy of that.
Okay. Maybe Bill can speak to that. Do you have is it a curb cut application, a driveway application?
It's a driveway application.
It's a driveway application, correct.
Have you obtained that at this point?
We submitted it to DOT, New Hampshire DOT. We won't get it until we submit the traffic study to them.
Can we get a copy of the application that you submitted
sure,
to the station?
Sure, I guess. Please. You have a copy of that, don't you, Ben?
Not with me.
No, I don't mean with you. Yeah, we can get you a copy.
Yes, I can get you.
Okay, thank you.
Okay.
You're on.
Mr. Chairman and members of the board, my name is Bill Eaton of Eaton Traffic Engineering in Thompson, Maine. And I don't have a traffic study to present you with tonight. I have conducted what I told you I would do at the last meeting, and that is an analysis of the morning peak hour, the peak period that would occur between 7 and 9 a.m. at the intersections of the Newmarket Business Park, the intersection of New Road, the intersection of Jerry Avenue and 108, the intersection of 108 and 152, and the intersection of Jerry Avenue and 152. We took counts out there during the month of August, understanding and knowing that there was construction going on, but it was possible, particularly when you look at the intersection of Jerry and 152, where nearly all the traffic everywhere was funneled through, you can recreate what would have happened had that section of Exeter Street not been closed down. So we have that information, and we've come out with some preliminary findings. Today I received from your planning director a copy of the letter from Mr. Robert Bollinger, who has been selected to perform the peer review for the traffic study, and in it he has indicated that he also would like the PM peak hour, which would occur between 4 and 6 p.m. to be done. And obviously, since I don't have count data for that, I couldn't do that and couldn't present that to you today. My apologies for that, but we will get that to you as soon as we can get those counts done. I think I can state fairly that my findings from the morning peak hour are going to constitute most of the off-site mitigation that would be required, simply because in the morning we're generating 330 vehicle trips to a Dunkin' Donuts and another four from the office. 70% of that traffic is drawn from traffic already passing by the site. So when you get done looking at that, what you end up with is you've got about 25 cars leaving the site to the north, 25 leaving the site to the south, 25 coming in from the south, and 25 coming in. When you start spreading that down to those other intersections, I think you'll agree that you're not really adding in many additional new cars to those intersections. And my analysis did indicate there are very, very minor changes in the levels of service for all of the intersections other than the intersection of Route 108 and the Newmarket Business Park. That is where the bulk of all of the traffic leaving the Dunkin' Donuts has to use that.
Can you tell me what the current level of service is of I'm thinking Jerry Avenue 108?
Of the Business Park?
Yeah. Well,
the Business Park is probably, and there's very, very little traffic coming out of the Business Park between 7 and 9 a.m. I'm not sure whether it's because it's not filled up or just that they don't
it's
get
not
on.
Built up.
There. Yeah, that's true.
Yeah, there's going to be another building that's going to be constructed, plus the second building hasn't been occupied yet. So,
okay.
So it's very well. Right now, it operates at basically level of service A. Okay. But what's really important from your perspective is what happens when you put all that Dunkin' Donuts traffic there. And what does happen is you end up with very long delays on the traffic coming out of the Business Park in the morning, okay, which probably won't change radically because most of the traffic going to the business park will, at that time of day, will be entering, not leaving. At night, they will be leaving. And what we find out is, because of the demand of everybody coming up from the south, has to make a left turn into the business park entrance in order to get to the Dunkin' Donuts. And the analysis indicates that that won't work well unless we install a left turn lane on Route 108. And it appears, based on my preliminary analysis, that in the year 2008, that would have to be approximately 50 feet long in order to not block the traffic, the through traffic behind it. And by the year 2018, it would probably need to be 75 feet long, so in that range. And obviously, we'll look at the same issue again for the PM peak hour. But those are the preliminary findings. Ben asked me to talk to you briefly about the circulation and the way it was working. I've been doing studies for Dunkin' Donuts for probably 20 years, and I've worked closely with them. These guys are constantly going to, you know, it's like McDonald's University. They have a Dunkin' Donuts University. You have to go back, the new techniques, the goals of how fast they have to move people through. It's a big science. The rule of thumb that I have been using that seems to work is that we need for storage on a Dunkin' Donuts, a typical Dunkin' Donuts, you need storage for 12 vehicles up to the menu board or 14 to the pickup window. And that generally, by observation at a number of Dunkin' Donuts, has worked. So that seems to be the maximum queues that we're looking at. What Ben has proposed here provides for the 12 up to the menu board, so that should handle 95% of the problems. The model that I used is called a synchro slash sim traffic model. It models individual cars, and I put it on a network that consisted of all of those intersections that I discussed with you before, and I can sit there and actually watch the cars. The problem is the model doesn't do a very good job of modeling how a pickup window works, so it's difficult to see. If we assume, which I think we can, that in this case, the traffic entering via the drive-through entrance, the right turn only, has the right-of-way. So traffic coming around the other side would have to stop. That guarantees that we can continually keep traffic off 108 moving into that line. And the max we would see is one or two sitting down in the right turn lane before we continue to go on. That's the way it's being proposed now. There is an alternate way. The alternate way is that traffic coming in off 108 would immediately either slide over into the lane if there were sufficient room and time for them to do that. If not, they couldn't break into the line, so what they would have to do is drive around the facility and get in the end of the line again, which could happen at very busy times in the morning. And in that case, a lot of people would have learned after a while that first thing in the morning, maybe it's a better thing to go in and enter via the Newmarket Business Park driveway and get in that way, rather than the other way around. But during the rest of the day, when business is slower, it's probably going to be very, very effective. Now that pretty much completes. Oh, an additional thing that Mr. Bollinger indicated he would like is a compilation of automobile accidents that occurred within the study area for the previous 3-year period. So we will be contacting New Hampshire DOT to find out where they keep that information, and we'll put that stuff together for you. I might note that it's a good chance, and I think Mr. Bollinger would agree with me, that any accident experience on Route 108 between Jerry Avenue and Route 152 is probably irrelevant at this point, since you're completely reconstructing that. Whatever problems may have been caused by physical or geometric issues hopefully would be addressed by this and shouldn't be showing up again.
All right. Are there any, Peter?
Oh, just, it is Bill, right?
Correct.
I'm sorry. Just got a couple of quick questions. You mentioned that the turn for, I think it was 108 North that you were referring to, that was going to go in the business park entrance, that there would be a stack lane or a turn lane of 50 feet now, and perhaps in 10 years another 25 feet more.
Yeah, that would be heading northbound. Turning left.
All right. I just want to make sure I understood you correctly. So basically what we're saying is 10 years down the road, we're probably going to see an increase of about 50% in traffic. Is that fair to say?
No. It works a little bit differently than that. The traffic, I used an increase factor of about 1% per year, which is about 10% increase in traffic. And that's pretty typical. But, you know, It didn't increase the queue. The queues are formed by the availability of gaps in oncoming traffic. Okay, the model that I used generates traffic that appears in a randomized fashion, at least from the outside of the network. And once it starts going through the stop signs, et cetera, and other traffic controls, that tends to set up the pattern that you see. So every time I run a different run, add some, change some numbers around, that random generation could be slightly different. In this case, you know, what I usually do is I run this simulation five different times, and the way the randomization is occurred is you have to give it a seed number. So if I give it a 1, I get one distribution of cars. If I give it a 2, I get a different distribution of cars. So I ran it using 1, 2, 3, 4, and 5, and it averages what happens under those conditions. And that's generally accepted to be a reasonable approach, particularly in using these simulation models.
You've been at this for some time. You've handled a number of Dunkin' Donuts and probably others. Give me a reason why I should drop my concerns about the traffic safety and the pedestrian safety and why Dunkin' Donuts or you can't abandon that southbound turnout.
Well, I can only respond to the site plan that has been presented to me. But, you know, this is not an uncommon part of a Dunkin' Donuts site plan. These things exist in quite a few other areas, and I'm not aware of any problems in those other areas. I'm entirely sympathetic to your concern, and it's understandable to look at that and say that could be a problem. I haven't seen it as constituting a problem at any location I'm aware of. That's not to say that it hasn't happened somewhere, but I'm not aware of that.
Okay.
Bill, is your modeling done in the wintertime also? Are you taking into account the snow and all this stuff in your modeling?
No. The model does a pretty good job, but it doesn't know what snow is going to do. I assume you're talking about narrowing of lanes?
Yeah, possibly, yeah. Okay, yeah. The other question I had is on that southbound, that curb cut where the southbound is going to enter the site, the automobiles coming, let's say, from the north, are they going to be able to make a left-hand turn at that curb cut?
Oh, you mean vehicles coming this way?
Yes.
No. To turn into here?
Yes.
No.
They won't be able to get in there?
No.
Okay. Because of the angle of it.
No left-hand turns.
God, what's going to prevent them from getting in there?
Because of the angle. The angle's too much.
It's not going to be impossible, and I have seen, if you go out and count traffic for a couple hours, you'd be surprised at what you what you haven't noticed in driving those roads for 20 years. You'll see a lot in 2 hours if you just stay in one place. And I've seen
you see it every time. John had a question.
Yeah, I have an observation and a question for you. My observation is that with the construction going on right now, one-way streets, one-way traffic has been created in front of the gas station down there as they're working on the other half of the road. And to that extent, the police, I think quite appropriately, have put signs in the middle of the road that state, do not stop on railroad track.
They still do.
And they still do. So my question to you is, in all your traffic studies and your modeling, have you considered no cut on 108 that all traffic has to go in through the business park?
I have not looked at that yet. It's not a big deal to do that, and I can do that as an extra item, but it's simply a matter of eliminating one of my streets and changing the volumes a little bit.
It's very obvious in the past meetings, and this gentleman went through the comments that we made in the past. It's very clear that cut on 108 southbound is a major problem, and that's a major concern. You're hearing it again tonight. So I would encourage you to consider something else.
Well, I guess the fairest way to answer you is I can analyze what would happen with that. But keep in mind that I'm working for a client who has a site plan that he is very fond of. Had I noticed something on this site plan that I thought raised a flag to me, based on my experience, I would have told them and you wouldn't have seen it. So obviously this didn't raise any flag for me because I've seen them before, they work. It's a normal part of the circulation thing. All site plans are compromises because you always have things that fight against, you know, you have a goal in one direction, you've got something else that pushes you back in the other direction. You're continually moving stuff back and forth and trying to come up with the best overall compromise that you can that works well.
Well, I would like to see a study with no cut.
As I say, it's very simple to do.
Good.
could you incorporate that into your scope of work for the traffic study?
I can do that. I just planned on just, I'll just do it. It's a matter of, you know, making a couple minor changes and pressing the mouse on the computer and letting it go fly off, and then I have to go get a cup of coffee or a drink of water because this program uses incredible amounts of memory, and it takes a while to run.
And I had one question, and that was, obviously, you've noted, especially during your traffic study, that the traffic pattern is slightly different, and DOT has said they don't see a big issue with that. Have you tried to look at past counts that or traffic data that we have there and see if the numbers that you're modeling come out similar?
I've done a little bit of checking, but today in the letter I got that Bob Bollinger sent back to Diane Hardy, he indicated that Steve Pernod did a big study back in 2001 and 2002. Mm-hmm. That had it, so I thought I'd give Steve a call and see if he had some of that data kicking around and yep. we could look at. But we did ask the New Hampshire DOT when we were them, and they really hadn't done anything right. in recent past.
Yeah, I mean, we do periodic counts every year, so there should be some fairly close valid counts in the past.
Yeah,
couple
it would
years.
Be helpful. I mean, it's sort
but
of
but no study per se.
Right. I mean, it's sort of like when you look at the intersection right out here, everybody turning left would have gone straight, because why would anybody drive up to Jerry Avenue to go back down to 108? So that would have happened. Right. But you know, you're right, there could be something else going on. It'd be nice to see some other counts just to make sure that we're right. in the reasonable ballpark. But you know, and then again, as I mentioned, other than the entrance, right. everything else is fine. I mean, okay. it's very typical for Dunkin' Donuts. The first thing I usually tell a client with a Dunkin' Donuts is, you're not going to have any big impact anywhere near the site, but you're probably going to have to put a left turn lane in, and you might want to put a right turn lane in too. And that's consistently what happens.
Thank you. And I think George had a comment.
Yeah, I just want a clarification. When you were talking about, I think, the drive-through and the queuing, you were saying that you could put something to prevent. I didn't quite catch it all. I'd like to more that you could, I guess, if people coming around from the other side to go through the drive-through. You could put something there to give the other people the right of way?
Well, there's two ways of handling it. First, okay. First, you would put a stop sign here to control these people so that this would be an uninterrupted flow. That's one way of doing it. The other way is you allow this to be the uninterrupted flow. When you've got cars back to here, it's no problem to slide in line. When you get cars back to here, it is a problem, and then you simply go around the site and get back at the end of the line. And I've seen it done both ways. And it is necessary to have that escape lane. It's for emergency vehicle purposes, and you know, I've had clients that tried to put one of these things in without them, and they didn't get very far with the planning board.
That was a stop sign issue that I guess I was trying to get.
Yeah, it's just a matter of establishing. You know, one of the best things about Dunkin' Donuts is once you get something figured out, it'll work almost forever, because Dunkin' Donuts customers tend to be the same people over and over and over again. You know, it's not like trying to do traffic planning in a tourist town where every day you've got a bunch of different people coming in that have never been there before. You've got to be really careful on how you do stuff. But in Dunkin' Donuts, where it's consistent, regular patrons, and then the people that don't know will see how it's working pretty quickly anyhow.
Bob, I got a question.
Chip?
Bill, on that going south and turn and getting at that curb cut, is there going to be enough room there for the cars to stack? Let's say you're showing three cars. From there to the railroad track, how many cars do you estimate could be stacked in there and still not impede the automobiles which are going to go south?
You've got a scale, Bill. I have to apologize. I didn't measure that distance, but we can get it. It appears to me we've got about a 50-foot stacking area, and then inside the taper area, you could mm-hmm. probably squeeze a car, too, because these lanes are like 11 and 12 feet wide. Most cars are 6 feet wide.
Mm-hmm.
Right from here. There it is. Yeah, 320
feet. And that wouldn't restrict other automobiles, which are coming behind him, which are going to go, let's say, to Exeter or to Stratton or whatever.
Yeah,
they'll have the room. In other words, they won't have to go into the oncoming lane.
I wouldn't think so, no.
All right.
No, I wouldn't anticipate. I can't say yeah. It would never happen.
I have the
but, you know, based upon my own experience and the fact that we've got room for 12 to 13 cars means most of the time there's not going to be a problem. Plus, you have a reasonably wide street out there, too.
We just looked at your engineering scale here. It's 160 feet, not 320 feet.
Sorry, it is 20.
Okay.
He was 160 feet.
Okay. Thank you.
Tighter.
We have scale here if you'd like.
Does that change the answer?
Well, no. My basic answer was we shouldn't be back beyond this point in here in any event. So to get back 160, 160 feet is roughly 6 to 7 cars.
That's to the railroad track. So yep. You're not right, going to have a right turn cars. Lane all the way back to the railroad.
Oh, no, track. No. No, but your concern that maybe I misunderstood the question, but the concern was could it, how possible it is it to go all the way back to the railroad tracks? And possibilities and probabilities are two different things. And yeah, it's possible, but the probability is very low.
But all you need is one accident.
All right. Is there other questions, comments? Yep. I think this is appropriate for parking.
We didn't hear the last time on the parking. We didn't hear, and I believe we asked, we didn't hear how many employees would be in the Dunkin' Donuts and how many employees would be upstairs and what was the parking requirement for those employees in both locations.
The parking cogs are identified on the plan.
No designated spots, right? There's no designated spots for the employee parking versus the customer parking versus the office parking, correct?
Correct. At this point, there's no separation. As mentioned on here, the restaurant requirement in the town is one space for three seats. We're going to have 27 seats, which would require 9 spaces. The office and business park would require 1 space for each 250 square feet of gross floor area. So there's 2,490 square feet divided by the 250 square feet is 10 spaces. A total of 19 spaces would be required. We are proposing 26 spaces. So we would have an additional 7 spaces.
Those would be for employees of the, Dunkin' Donuts?
Not necessarily. They would be for whoever needed the parking, whether it be Dunkin' Donuts or the business park.
Diane, correct me if I'm, or maybe Diane and Bob, but I think that's inclusive of the multiplier we're using or the criteria we're using is inclusive of the employees in the establishment.
That is correct.
So although you're asking about the employees about the Dunkin' Donuts, that's included in the multiplier.
Right. Although I question the applicability of the one parking space per 3 seats for the restaurant because that's for a traditional sit-down type restaurant. It's not for a high-volume takeout restaurant. We have a drive-through line and so forth. And
I think we need to
look at maybe some other standards through the ITE that might be a little more appropriate for the type of use that's being proposed here.
To quickly respond to that, this is a high turnover restaurant, as you're saying.
Right.
So the fact that there is 27 seats in there, it's probably not likely that all 27 seats are ever going to be filled. And the greater possibility that is, as one car is leaving, another car is coming in, the turnover is much higher. So the number of parking spaces you'll need for a breakfast time period is actually less.
What is the relationship between Dunkin' Donuts and Baskin-Robbins?
I have no idea.
I've seen a number of Dunkin' Donuts and Baskin-Robbins together. Are they owned by the same corporation?
I honestly have no idea.
There's no idea of bringing in a Baskin-Robbins in this same facility, is there?
Correct, no.
Peter?
We spoke briefly last time, and it may have been a point that slid off the table, but have you made a note to put a stop sign in at the exit?
Here?
No, right up at the corner where they enter the entrance to the little back.
Here?
That'll be good, but I want to move it up so you can see the traffic that's coming in and out to see whether or not. In other words, if I'm coming in from 108, I don't want somebody to cut in front of me because I'm going to the doctor's office and they assumed I was going to the Dunkin' Donuts.
Correct.
Good point.
I will make a note of it.
Please.
I apologize.
And a couple more comments, and then I'm going to open it up to public for their comments, and then we'll come back to the board. So, is there anything further from the board?
Mm-hmm. Before we close, Wendy would still like to discuss her landscaping. Thank you.
Wendy Anderson from Woodburn & Company. I believe the... I don't know if you want me to go through the planting plan again. I do have it here, but the main thing that I wanted to show you was something that we discussed because of the last meeting, and I'm not sure everyone understood what was going on with the site, and the way the topography is on the site, I think, makes a difference on how you view it. So I did an elevation, and I compared it to what is there now, and I hope you can see this. If not, I can try to raise this up, but... as far as viewing into the site, and if you see, I'll just give you a comparison. Over here, this light green tree. I hope you can see it. Maybe we can come back here. But
just,
yeah,
maybe
if you have it,
it's better.
Actually, Mike, can you close that laptop?
Yeah, just put the. There you go. Perfect.
Sweet.
Excuse me. Is there a way to do this so the audience can see it as well?
Yeah, I mean, we can do as much as we can if you could try to tip it flat, but it's a limitation of this room. And you can feel free to stand up and move over here. But
if you see the light colored tree, I'm not sure if you can see it back from back there, but you can take a closer look. I've tried to scribble in a smaller tree here that would show the size of what the tree would go in as. It's about this size. So probably about half the foliage mass. But over a 20-30 year period, which is about what these sizes are on the existing trees that are on the site, see the canopy will fill in and basically cover it up. And what's happening is that because the topography on the site from the street goes up, where the building is right now, it's actually up at the bottom. That's the bottom of the building right there. And you'll see that actually even when the trees go in as small, they'll cover up some of the bottom of the building. As they grow, they'll cover up more of the building. But really the main point is that you don't see much of the building because it is raised up from the street. And so most of the foliage will cover that up over time, as opposed to one that's at street level, you'd still be able to see 10 feet, 8 feet of the building, which now you wouldn't be able to do that.
I think it's the parking that we're worried about, not actually seeing the building.
Yeah. Parking right here is covered up as well. The bottom of that would cover up some parking. If you can see this little green blob right here, that's a car. And of course, where the trees aren't, you will see some. But there's a fence in front because this is a retaining wall right here. There is a fence that would help also break up your view of cars. And over here, if you see the left side of the site where the parking lot is perpendicular to the street, and you see some cars parked here, I've included shrubs that will help cut down on the visibility of those. And also along this street. So it's actually, if you'd be coming northbound on 108, you would also not see as much of the cars because there's shrubs along that side of that parking as well. You see here this dark green line, that's shrubs that help mitigate the retaining wall there, so you wouldn't be able to see very much of that. It blends in. Let's see what else is there. I think the other issue you had was with the existing trees, and I can only work with what I'm given and what's being proposed as far as a planting plan goes, but if you forget the existing plan as it's proposed, the site is commercial, and if you propose any kind of commercial building, you usually have to have a parking lot with it. The topography of the site is that because it's raised up in the back, or actually there's topography, pretty steep topography through this whole site, parking lots generally have to be flat, and you have to do some grading throughout the whole site. And this site, with parking lot and a building, most of the site, unfortunately, has to be regraded, which destroys existing trees. We've tried to put as many trees as we possibly can, and you can see in the future it will look wonderful. Even when it's installed, it will look pretty good because of the number of trees. At least I hope you think so. So unfortunately, yes, some existing interior trees have to go, and I know you were concerned about that, the age of the trees, but trees grow, and we're hoping that if we plant these, they'll be even healthier than what's there now. And they get old too, and eventually they will be large and hopefully even healthier because they've been taken care of. So if there's any questions, I hope I can answer those.
Just clarification, is that a revised elevation that you're showing us here as opposed to the plan?
The only revision is this row of trees right here. I wasn't aware that actually some small trees had already been planted along the entrance. So I added these, and that's what those would be, is these along there. Those actually are planted out there right now, and they will, again, I've scribbled in the small size about what they are now in black, but they will grow larger.
The reason I ask is because mm-hmm. I have a landscape plan apparently that was date stamped July 30th, and it shows nothing but shrubs up front. I don't see any tall trees except in the corner on the right of your drawing. Mm-hmm.
This is the plan that was submitted here, so I'm not sure. Let's see.
Okay, well,
July 6th.
That's different than what I have in mind, Mike. July 30th.
Okay. Wendy, what kind of trees are those?
There are different trees throughout the site, and I tried to vary them so that if disease ever happens to come along, you're less likely to lose all of your trees. We have Amelanchier here, which is a small flowering tree. We have flowering pears here. We have ash. We have in this area where more of the water is. If you can see in these areas, this is your areas that handle your water when you get rain. The runoff from the parking and the driveways. And since ash can take more water, I chose ash. Along up here in the upper areas, I've used oak. Those generally are in upland kinds of trees, so I use those, and they can handle more dry situations and rocky situations. I chose some London planes in this area here for size, because they get really nice and big, and the foliage covers up more. So does that answer your question?
These are all deciduous trees.
Yeah.
They are. The only evergreen trees are the ones along the right here, and there's a hedge that helps mitigate the residents on that side.
It appears that the landscaping plan that we have and that was distributed to the planning board is not the most recent landscaping plan.
Okay.
So it would be helpful to get that. You want to see what we have?
Yeah, because this should be the one that was submitted.
Unless we're not interpreting it correctly.
Yes, it's like the tree layers. It's the same plan, but
okay. Can you? Yeah.
Yes.
I have one question, Wendy. The rendering that you show us, which shows really a good screening of the building and the site. How many years down the road are we talking for the maturity of those trees to give that kind of a visual impact?
I would say about 20. Okay. You know, which that's what trees take to grow, unfortunately. And we put them, I think the requirement is putting the trees in at 3-inch caliper, which is larger than a lot of towns, so you're going to get a bigger bang for your buck in installation anyway, so they will be larger than
general. Did I read somewhere in your presentation or on the plan that this does not meet the exact letter of our requirements with respect to the number of trees per square footage
square
of the area?
Yes. And to address that, actually, I did a calculation on what we generally do is space deciduous trees, shade canopy trees, at 30 foot on center. It's healthier for the trees to do that. And if you take a 30 foot canopy, that covers 700 square feet. Your requirement is one tree per 500 square feet of disturbance. That's actually really tight if mm-hmm. you try to fit that on there. Mm-hmm. And I believe for this particular site, it's asking, it's actually meets what we can, and the actual general requirement actually is tighter than what we would recommend. So that kind of addresses the number.
Could we have a specific waiver request from those requirements with a justification, as Wendy has just explained it to us, so that the board can formally vote on that as a waiver from the requirements?
Okay. Any other questions?
Also, George?
Yeah. Could you repeat the requirement again? How you figured it out? I'm just trying to figure out if maybe there's a discrepancy.
Well, your requirement is for every 500 square feet of disturbance, you require one tree. And if you take a 30-foot canopy on a tree, which all of, except the small flowering trees, will get actually larger than 30. The average maturity of a tree, deciduous shade canopy tree, is a 30-foot diameter canopy. That canopy, when you figure it out, it takes up 700 square feet. So if you want 500 square feet, and really you only recommend 700 square feet, you're asking for more trees than would be healthiest for the tree. That's kind of the point I'm trying to make.
It's late in the evening, but I'm not sure, I'm not sure the math is the same. The criteria is for every 500 square feet of disturbance, you put a tree in. Not a tree that covers 500 square feet, but a tree.
Tree. Correct.
So before you ask for the waiver, make sure that that's, again, you'd have to sit down and do all the it's not a, it, I don't think how you explained it is exactly a one-to-one. Am I making myself clear?
Mm-hmm. I think so.
How much, first figure how much disturbance this whole thing is taking, and that'll tell you how many trees you have to put in. You still might have a point that it may be too many trees. But I don't, based on what you just said, I'm not sure it's figured out exactly right.
Well, I think it's probably true because, I mean, this is going to be 85% impervious, so there's not a lot of room for trees. If there was more of a lot, then the amount of trees would fit fine. But
we're not asking for trees that have that cover 500 right. square feet either.
No, I understand.
So there may be the way, you understand the difference?
I understand that the number of trees that you want, but when you look at how much a tree covers, if there was no parking lot and no building on this site, you still wouldn't be able to fit at the 30 feet on center, you still wouldn't be able to fit the 80 required trees. Unless you chose ones that were columnar, you could do that, but most people aren't satisfied with columnar trees. You know, the big, wide canopy is what most people want. And you could put the number of trees on if you put small trees, but I think you want canopy trees, you know, because an ornamental
tree
only takes
up smaller space. That's fair. I'm not arguing. I'm not necessarily. I just want to make sure we have the right calculation.
Yeah. Okay.
Thank you, George.
Check it very carefully.
Are there further questions?
It's on my mind. In terms of the evergreens you were talking about on the boundary, have you thought of putting any out front? Is that a possibility?
You mean to cover up everything?
Yes, not necessarily all of them. I mean, could they be spotted with evergreen?
You could, but I'm concerned about visibility.
In regards to the business itself?
Well, no, because this covers that up, at least in the summertime. No, because most And you could do arborvitae, but what's happening on the site here is that some of the detention basin here that you can't see because it's in elevation is actually starting to go down below here. You can't see it, but it's down below the edge of the road. Here. What's happening is that most evergreen trees don't do well in wet. And you have most of this area, you'd want it to be tolerant of being wet. Not that it's going to be soaking wet all the time, but you at least want them to be able to handle it. And also over here. As far as the property line goes, there's really not a lot of room, and evergreens do get wide.
Okay, I just brought it up.
Mm-hmm. So basically you're saying that this canopy and all will hide the building half of the year.
Yes, but you know, tree...
20 years from now.
20 yes. years. But, well, you have to remember the two when you put them in. You guys are asking for a fair 3-inch caliper trees, which do have a...
That's a substantial size
It's a substantial tree. Canopy. It's not as big as what I'm showing here, but, you know, they grow. That's what they do. They grow. So they're not going to get any smaller. But branches also give you a break from that. And if you look at the plan, let me hold it again, you actually have two rows of branches. So even in the wintertime, even though there's no foliage, you're going to have that break. And most people aren't going to be standing across the street staring into the site going, oh, you can see that. They're going to be walking by and actually looking this way, because that will actually cover up more, and a lot more people are going to be driving by, and they really should be looking in front of them and not to the 90 okay. degrees to the right. But deciduous trees do, in branching, provide visibility breakup as well. So.
Thank you, Wendy. At this point, I want to open it up to public comment, and we'll come back to the board. I have a feeling there's going to be a little bit of public comment. So, ma'am. And again, address the board. Please state your name and address for the record.
Gail DeRocher-Wentworth, 27 Beach Street in the Village. I just wanted to say thank you for this opportunity, my first town meeting here. Thank you. This has been very educational. I just had a couple of concerns that I wanted to share. I heard a lot of the benefit towards Dunkin' Donuts. And it's great that they can list the benefits to themselves. However, I think we need to think about the benefits to this town. There are already two Dunkin' Donuts before you reach 101 when you're going south. And I find it really interesting. Oh, there are four. Thank you. There's already one coffee shop offering coffee services in the downtown area, which is locally owned. And I think that company's name is called Crack Skulls. And I do believe that they already align themselves with a downtown revitalization focus of community. So the question that I want to ask is, there are two. We're going to see a lot of increasing in residential housing in the downtown. And this is going to increase the amount of southbound traffic in the near future. We're not talking 20 years from now. We're talking a few years from now. The town is growing, and thank goodness. And my last question that I want to ask is, what exactly is our heritage? We're celebrating our heritage in a few weeks, and it's a great opportunity to think about our community, who we are and what we stand for. And I ask that, is our heritage, looking back on these plans, going to be big business or locally owned businesses? When we celebrate next year around this time our heritage, are we going to have any shops downtown that we can go, locally owned, to support our heritage in Newmarket? Or are we going to be stuck in traffic trying to find parking spaces when we go to these celebrations of our town? So those are the questions that I'm asking.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Sir.
Okay. Buzz Dieterle again, Smith Garrison Road. If there's one scream in Newmarket for the 30 years that I've lived here, it's that we can't afford to live here. The planning board at the time fought hard and dear to get the town to rezone that area. The first zone went back 150 feet, I think, or so, and then was eventually expanded under a town council. I could be wrong, and I'll be properly chastised, but I am here listening to what is becoming an adversarial relationship between some members of this board and this developer. The community consciously set aside that area of town for commercial development because we need the tax base. The chair reminded me earlier when I was talking about the Cheney development that there are certain things that can be done by law and can't be done by law. But I've heard at least three members of the planning board in this discussion talk about what they like versus what the regulations require.
I think that that's a very fine point. The thing that I would point out is that as the planning board, we do have the discretion of trying to, exactly as you asked us earlier, work with a developer to get something that works well for the town. So let's not just approve something just because it is allowed.
No,
let's look at what works best for everyone.
I'm not asking you to, okay? However, I would dare say that I could leave here tonight knowing at least how one member is going to vote on this without looking at anybody in particular beyond the chair, and I'm not looking at you for that reason. That there's at least one member who's made up his board member tonight, and there are two other members that have attacked, have in their body language and in the tone of their questioning, have attacked the developer. The developer has been chastised at least twice tonight for his misspeaking. That is not a pro business welcoming atmosphere. This is a commercial zone. Yes, make it look nice, but it's not going to look pretty up against Brooks, McDonald's, Irving. It's not an area of town where you can invoke architectural jurisdiction that mirrors the mills downtown because we like it.
I think the point of the board tonight is that the plan as we're seeing it is not something that's overly acceptable to us. It has very little to do actually with architecture. And I think it has more to do with, we're very concerned about the traffic impacts, and I'm very concerned about the idea that someone's going to get whaled on the train tracks by a train because they're queued for Dunkin' Donuts. It's something that I've seen huge queues like that, and it's of grave concern to me.
And that is a fair concern, but you haven't even given them a chance to present their finished traffic study. And yet members have raised the concern, and other members have hammered it home as if there's no way they're going to be satisfied. And I'm not looking to argue the points. I'm here to say my piece. I see this as an adversarial as opposed to a cooperative arrangement. I'm a taxpayer that's having trouble living in this town. I think I speak for the people that have cried in this town for year after year to bring businesses to this town. No, not roll over and play dead. I want safe businesses. I want productive businesses. I want contributing businesses.
And I understand what you're saying, and I think that that's the exact reason why there's a business park there, and it's slowly getting filled up. So I think we're working for the same thing that you're asking us to work for.
And I hope the rest of the board members are, too, and I'll leave it at that.
Thank you. Roseanne?
Sir, you're next.
Roseanne Fox, Wadley Falls Road, Newmarket, and I want to say that I feel the board is doing an excellent job. This isn't the board that approved Brooks and Irving and everything else. And this, I think this board's doing due diligence for the safety and for the aesthetic components that Newmarket deserves with all the money we're putting into revitalization. And you should be applauded for the kinds of questions that you're asking tonight. Other than that, I had some questions. The trees on the outer edge that they said will have to be removed, were those trees indicated on the prior approval that had to remain?
That's a very good question, and we'll add it to the list of items to research,
okay.
Mrs. Quack.
And also in the remarks, not just the conditions of the Newmarket Business Park approval, but in the remarks made, which, you know, according to RSA, you have to adhere to, was there any restriction on the type of business like this gentleman back here referred to as to restaurant? I know it's a use by right in that zone, but by doing the boundary line adjustment and making that one parcel, do the requirements and statements and conditions made on the prior approval pertain to what could possibly go there in the future? And also,
I think the answer to that is it would matter what order we did the lot line versus this application, I would think.
If they mentioned in that last meeting that they were proposing future lot line development anything was mentioned as to regarding what they would not be putting, that would pertain to this, I believe.
Can I just clarify? Are you talking about the previous meeting? Are you talking about when the approval of the office
park? The original
park,
office
the
park.
The office park?
Yes.
That's what I think. Not the lot line adjustment that was just today presented.
The lot line adjustment
for the office park when it was first approved.
No, when they make the lot line adjustment discussed tonight, this parcel for Dunkin' Donuts will now become part of the existing office park.
Correct, yes. I understand that.
Was that discussed during the last meeting, that they proposed to do that?
That they specified specific uses within the corporate park, and that was the basis for the approval, is that what you're suggesting?
Yes.
And that, yeah. I think what we would need to do is go back and look at the records. Mm-hmm. I think the relevance of, you know, the type of use may be a consideration in a zoning board approval, but if in the planning board approval process, if it is a use that is permitted, the planning board's role is to look at the site design aspects of the plan and not to view the appropriateness or the compatibility of the proposed use.
I'm just questioning whether or not something was mentioned that would prohibit the current use that they're proposing now.
Again, we'd have to research the records.
And also, with all the non-pervious going in there, the bowl is downstream from that development. Is this situation going to increase that, precipitate a worse situation for flooding down there in the bowl? To what degree? And if that's the case, would any off-site improvements be indicated in order to help eliminate or alleviate that problem of flooding down the road?
I think if there was any off-site if there was any drainage coming off-site, there would have to be off-site improvements to
fix
that.
Are they doing catch basins that's going into the...
It's an infiltration system, and the engineer, I think the engineer should address the drainage.
If I can just...
Yeah, just finish your point.
So I can sit down. And also, I'd like to know if Bill did the study for the relatively new Dunkin' Donuts in Dover. Mm-hmm. And if he did, I would like to have the planning board do a site walk down there, because I understand the queuing of cars down there is unbelievable. I'd like to know when that Dunkin' Donuts was put in, what their traffic study indicated as to the problems they would have, and what the actual problems are now. And that would be a key spot to go for a site walk. And I would like to know if the planning board is going to have their own traffic study done. I have issue with someone who's been doing traffic studies for Dunkin' Donuts for 20 years for you folks to adhere to what he recommends.
We have an engineer to review those.
Okay, and I'm concerned about the retaining wall in front. I wouldn't like to see any type of interlock. And also, the types of trees used in front are deciduous. Certain pear trees have a tendency to split. I hope she's planning on using types that don't split when they get about 7 or 8 years old. And if she's also looked at the list of invasive trees such as burning bush, there's a Cantaniaster, and of course we all know about the Norway maple.
We're a big fan of that here.
Yeah, yeah. And none of those to be used, and I'd like the retaining wall to be, I would rather see evergreens there. And if there's a problem for water retention on the left side, if you can mitigate with some engineering so that you could put evergreens across the whole front. Because I don't know of any business that really wants their entire building blocked with evergreens, and especially the type of building that I think the town expects to be there should look very lovely and really shouldn't have to be covered by trees, because I think it's going to look like a lovely little colonial, because it'll complement the business park. And a nice little sign with very little pink on it out front would be just great. So you really don't have to cover the whole building. Just hide some of the parking with trees that are not deciduous.
That's it.
Thank you.
And 1 second. I wanted to bring up the developer first to speak to a couple of the questions. Bill, did you happen to be involved in the traffic for the Dover Dunkin' Donuts? Just out of curiosity.
No, I didn't. The last one I did is in Wiscasset, Maine, and I'd be more than happy to conduct a tour of that. And I'd also like to state that I am a registered professional engineer in the state of New Hampshire, and we are bound by a code of ethics. And I think that where that comment is directed, I think, should be clear to the board.
Thank you. And she'd asked.
Oh.
We understand you're a professional engineer, and you are absolutely bound when you put your stamp on there. It's, I think all of us understand that. And there was a question for the developer that I'm having trouble remembering.
It was a question on stormwater and whether there'd be any increase on off-site runoff and what plans are being proposed for stormwater retention or infiltration systems. If you could review the details of that, that would be helpful, Ben.
As I mentioned, we did submit a stormwater plan, which attenuates the 2-10 and 25-year storm events. This shown in the grading plan. There's three catch basins proposed to collect water off of the main parking area. These three catch basins will be have oil separators as part of their construction. On either side are swales with stone check dams to help slow down the run of the water. There's then a detention pond on either side with an underground detention pond underneath the driveway. This area here will attenuate peak flows for the 2-10 and 25-year storm. This system does tie in with the existing underground drainage system, which is required.
Could you clarify that it's designed for the 25-year storm so that it would not accommodate a 100-year storm similar to the last two storms that we experienced in the last 2 years here in Newmarket?
By the ordinance, we're required to look at the 2-10 and 25, and that's what we have done.
Great. Thank you. And I saw... Sorry about delaying you so many times.
Al Knight, 59 Exeter Street. The vice chairman made a good observation about people stopped on the railroad tracks. With this recent construction, originally there was no sign people were staying on parking on the railroad tracks. They brought up a sign, people are still on the railroad tracks, so now, as of last Friday, they had to have a flagman up on the railroad tracks. Another fact is that 25 miles an hour takes 127 feet to stop, and the speed limit is 30 miles an hour. So, and I paced off 160 feet, and I really believe that it's less than 160 feet to where this entrance is supposed to be. And it's not going to be a question of if there's going to be an accident. It's going to be the severity of the accident and the frequency. Because as another thing being queued up, everybody from the company said that there's a steep incline to go up. Well, what happens during the winter when it's raining and snowing and freezing? People are going to be in a queue on a grade, and they're going to lose traction. Some people can't drive in the snow, and they're going to back right up into the road. So you add that in to a car coming over the railroad tracks at 30 miles an hour, and you've got a recipe for disaster. And it's just some facts that can't be changed. Parking doesn't even begin legally until my house. From my house all the way down to the railroad tracks, there's not enough room to park on the northbound. The southbound is only a 3-foot, not even a breakdown lane, but a little line. Now, if you look up at Irving's and Dunkin', and not Dunkin' Donuts, but Irving's and McDonald's, you've got at least 4 lanes with enough room for 2 more lanes if you had to. So there's no place there for a deceleration lane. The town just spent gobs of money putting in brand new sidewalks that are 8 inches high. So it's just I can't say what we used to say in the Marine Corps, but you can't put 2 pounds of coffee in a 1-pound bag. And all these things just add up. They couldn't pick a worse place in town for safety reasons to put this place. And one thing I want to add on is the runoff. I just witnessed the big thunderstorm Saturday, and just coming down from where the Wentworth Douglas, where their park is now, it's a torrent. The water goes so fast it doesn't even go in the drains. It just goes right on down the road. So you add on another equivalent to that, another equivalent to the size of the parking lot, and you're going to really add significantly to the amount of water in these storms. And, you know, we've had 200-year storms in 2 years. So, you know, a 25-year storm is like a, well, you know, it's like a shower, the way things are. So I think this is not, you know, I got nothing against Dunkin' Donuts, but safety reasons, you can't pick a worse place in town to put this thing. Thank you.
Thank you. Is there other public comment, sir?
Martin McKenzie again. I just wanted to start with a couple of comments on of a seasonal nature. I mean, people have pointed out that the coverage as they have it now with deciduous trees would be a 6-month ordeal. I mean, a 6-month period. The rest of the time we would have branches there. Actually, I think it would be interesting, you know, maybe we could get a design drawing of what this might look like, say, in 10 years, let's not necessarily go 20 years down the line, in January, what that landscape might look like, what the landscaping there might look like. Certainly, this is it seems like a vast improvement from the kind of buffering that they have in some of the other constructions down there now, which would be, what, Brooks, Irving. And I guess my other seasonal observation would be, I'm not really sure when the traffic study was done, but I think that any traffic study done certainly during August might be questioned in terms of how representative that is. And, you know, that is before the university community comes back in. There is certainly much more northbound traffic in the morning during the school year and when the students are back. Again, in terms of traffic, if this was done when the construction was going on, which I understand it was, because of some of the backups that occur there, many people like myself, I'm sure, seek alternate routes, so I'm not really sure that those numbers on the amount of traffic going through there would really be representative of traffic on 108 in a standard year. So that's something that I think should be taken into consideration when looking at the traffic study. Thank you.
And to quickly address that, that's why I asked that you look at some counts that have been there in the past and see if it comes close to meshing. And the other thing I'd throw out there to you is the regional transportation model, which tries to model for the best time to work with, mm-hmm. is actually based on the third week in August. So he's actually right at the time where we would want him to be. So
okay, that's fine. But again, I would suggest that maybe with the construction going on, people are absolutely seeking alternate routes. So
yep, absolutely.
Keep that in mind as well.
Yep. And the UNH students is a very good point as well. Thank you. Is there, yes, sir.
My name is Walter Cheney. I actually created this Newmarket Business Park for the sole purpose, because after 10 years of being in this town and listening to the public saying we got to somehow offset our personal residence income tax. Our taxes are getting out of control. I happen to come into the ability to take this piece of property and look at, okay, what would be the best for the town? Not necessarily for me, but for the town. So I go through the process. I could have put on that piece as it is, no variances, no nothing, 22,000 square feet of building, which would have looked like any one of those buildings up on Bennett Way in the middle of that neighborhood. Personally, I felt that wouldn't be the best thing. I said, you know what? In the big run, easy for me. Long term, easy for me. I said, we got to look at what can we do that's going to work for the town. So I say, okay, let's break it up. I go with two buildings. Still didn't feel right to me. Okay. So now I look at the community, business is screaming for, and or community is screaming for, trying to offset residential taxes. Okay, what can we do? I create a business park that this town created the zone for. Every single residence in this zone is non-conforming. The lots are non-conforming. This business that is looking to come into this town, that is looking to create jobs, not only for the young, for the old, for the middle age, you name it. They are looking to create an aesthetic building that, from what I have seen, is way better than what's existing on the so-called entryway into Newmarket as it stands today. I wish I could stand here and say that I'm less than happy with the process that has taken place today, but I'm not. Just like the gentleman before me, if this town would like to have businesses offset residential taxes, this kind of forum cannot continue, because businesses are not going to want to come and have the third degree and have micromanagement on their traffic flow, on this thing, on that thing. We have a business that's looking to come into this town that is going to take two non-conforming lots, create a single conforming lot to today's standards governed by this town and its ordinances, and it's being given the third degree. It is being micromanaged to the umpteenth degree on its traffic flow, on its traffic in, the state, who I've talked to multiple times, has no problem with that southbound entrance. Why? We have 2.5 entrances, as far as they're concerned, that are going to be cut down to one. It's all one-way traffic. It eliminates a lot of stuff that they have to deal with today. All of that seems to be right over everybody's head. I don't know. So it is nothing but an improvement. And on top of the fact, this is a conforming use within the ordinance of today. Nothing else on that street is conforming. Not the lot size, not the buildings, nothing. Wish I had some water.
Sorry.
I worked hard to create this entity. I went through a lot of hoops. I doubted myself as to the viability of this town and its need for this kind of entity. This business park is already, in and itself, between the two entities that are there, have created more tax base than the entire street combined. If you take all the value of all those houses from those railroad tracks to Irving, you will not find the value that has already been created in that business park. I've been trying very hard to not do what I'm doing right now, but I gotta speak out and say, I truly believe Newmarket has a great future. That's why we're here today. I truly believe that the community in itself needs services. Those services are trying to be provided. Granted, there are services downtown today that have all the same things. And just like every one of you will drive by a mobile to go to a Sunoco, or will go to a Cumberland Farms over in Irving. Those decisions are individual. I also can't help but feel that people out sitting on that board today make us as educated individuals who have a choice, not only in the fact that we're driving, yes, we come into a new situation, whether it's the stop sign right out front compared to where there was never a stop sign, or a new business that somebody is going to travel into. Is there going to be some confusion now and then? Sure. Is there going to be issues traffic-wise for a little bit of time? Sure. But I'm an educated person, okay? I will adapt to whatever the new circumstance is. I will choose, do I want to go downtown to the bookstore slash coffee store, whatever, for a coffee and actually hang out and read, or maybe sitting on the sidewalk? Or am I going to run into Dunkin' Donuts, grab a coffee, and keep going? Those are choices I, as an individual, make on a daily basis. One day could be different from the next, just like anybody else. So I would like for this board to understand this zone was created for this sole purpose, to create business in this town that's going to generate jobs, not only for our young, for our middle-aged, and for our elder. Provide a service for those who want it. If they want the fast coffee, they're going to go here. If they want to sit down and hang out and talk to Joe Blow in town, they'll maybe go downtown. All of that is up to them. So I'm just trying to say,
yeah, I understand your concern.
I
think the one thing that I would point out to you is, of your statements, the one thing that I do take exception to is we are actually elected for the sole purpose of looking right down to the finest details of these sites, and that's our exact job as given to us by the state through RSA. Beyond that, I agree with you. Newmarket wants a bigger tax base. Newmarket does want businesses, and we're fine to have a business go in there. We just need it to be a site that works for us.
And I think that's great, because aesthetically, I think if you look at the proposed building compared to what's there, it works with the residential neighborhood.
I don't disagree.
The traffic flow works with the residential neighborhood. I would like that there's more thought on the fact that it is a business zone. We are trying to bring business into this town. If that is not what this town is trying to create, well, then we need to eliminate the business zone so that residential growth can continue, and that would be the case. But I just feel that sitting in the sidelines, there's a lot of micromanagement. We have professionals with credentials way beyond any of us sitting in this room telling us traffic flow or light or whatever the deal is. And it doesn't seem to be good enough for some of the people sitting up there.
Again, I remind you that it's exactly our job to micromanage us, as you're saying. And I think that the one misconception I also want to point out is we're not against the business. We're not against this use necessarily. I think it just needs to fit into a site that we can rely on to be safe for the community. And that's what it comes down to.
Okay. Well, I hope
that. And I thank you for your comments. There's any other comments from the public? All right. Seeing none, I'll close the public comment period. And I bring it back to the board for discussion and or a motion.
Just want to clarify for the board, the purpose of tonight's hearing is to determine whether or not the application is complete. And if so, the board would then make a vote to accept the application. And that starts the 65-day time clock I have some concerns that we do not have the traffic report in hand at this point, and it would be my recommendation that we continue the acceptance hearing until our October meeting, until such time as we get the traffic report in hand, and then we will have a complete application and we can move forward with technical reviews at that time and the continued design review on the part of the board.
All right.
I have a question.
Yes, Chuck.
Out of all the talk we've been going through with the automobiles, the foot traffic has never been discussed. Somebody walking north on the right-hand part of the road, if they want to cross, has this been thought of by